More volume, like now. This one, please.
Yeah, that's better. Is that max?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. So I can speak a little bit away and then everybody can hear. Can everybody at the back hear me? The two gentlemen speaking to each other. Can you hear me on the microphone? Warm welcome to you. Warm welcome to you. Okay, let's get this show on the road. We have a clicker right here. Video streaming team, would you mind switching to the presentation mode? That way we can get the show going. We have Faye that's with us. She got her sticker. That's wonderful. We have our wonderful group of panelists. And yeah, everybody, thank you for joining us on this really hot Saturday. We've actually done our best to give you some kind of cooling air. I think the misters will turn on in a couple of minutes. Well, can we go back to full screen, please? Thank you, thank you. How are we looking? Good. As soon as it's on, then you can just let the machine live its life. Okay, okay, okay. Can we get just the cursor off the screen if that's possible? Wonderful stuff, wonderful stuff. All right, everybody. Thank you for joining us on the third edition of Angels and Founders. I know we've all been waiting a little bit this morning, so I'm not going to take too much time introducing too many things. Whoops, guys. Okay, we're just going to run it like this. That's fine. You can all see me better. So, Angels and Founders, very simple concept. Every couple of weeks, every couple of months, we bring together some of Indonesia's top rising talent, and we introduce them to some of Indonesia's potential investors, people that are looking at the space, people that are looking to participate in the development of Indonesia. And the concept Angels and Founders is really about bringing these two parties together in a format built around knowledge exchange. Today is not about terrifying the startups at the pitch. It's really about bringing a new perspective, a new point of view on the solutions and on the problems that they're trying to solve, and to create opportunity for new collaboration. So look around you. Everybody's here with obviously something on their mind. They're trying to achieve something out of the session. Think about why you're here, what you've come to get. We've created this little sticker system today. We have red, green, and black. Green meaning talent, red meaning investor, black meaning collaborator. So when you look around, you'll be able to recognize people who they're supposed to represent. And this is going to help with a networking section coming up, which will be facilitated by Master Gil Petersil. Thank you very much for joining us, and thank you very much for your ongoing support. I'd like to call Faye up on stage, because Angel and Founders would not be possible without the support of KUMPUL and Mrs. Faye.
Thank you, Tom. Welcome all. And I love to see, like, also, you know, the panelists over there, like you said, that they are not here to roast the startups, but really just to give feedback, questions, and then maybe some inputs of collaborations. So I'm Faye Wongso from KUMPUL. And then at the beginning of the year, we started to talk with Bali Investment Club to see how best we can actually grow the ecosystem together, in especially the pre-series A-level startups. Because when we take a look at the investment field in Indonesia, we've actually attracted one of the highest number of investment in the last 2 years in the region. But everything is all big size tickets. In average, it's 100 million USD ticket size. So what does it say? The money is there, but the investors are playing safe. So they're investing in businesses who have the track record of growth. Then it's like Series B, Series C, and then it's basically the valuation games onwards, right? And for us, it's all about the pyramid. So if we don't have a healthy pyramid, your pyramid will be very, very thin. You can't have enough quality startups that solve Indonesian problems if you don't work on the bottom. So Angels and Founders are actually a lot of ecosystem players coming together to try to make that bridge and connections. We feel that we still need stronger angel network. This is also to give access connections of talents, people who are actually doing real things for impact in Indonesia, and people who wants to invest their energy, their time, and their money as angels. And we want to attract good quality angels. Don't be a bad angel, right? No? So today it's all about community as well. It's all about trying to learn from both sides. Being in Bali, sometimes I've been living in Bali since 2011. Sometimes we are sort of trapped in our own Bali bubble, and angels and founders try also to bridge this. So this is our third event, and actually we try to alternate this with Jakarta. So the first one was in Ubud, the second one was in Jakarta, this is the third one in Canggu, and we will try to do the fourth one in Jakarta, correct? And like that, we actually have a flow of connections and collaborations of the networks we built here, international talents, Indonesian talents, investors, startups, and let the ecosystem grow. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Faye. All right, all right. So I always forget to do this, is actually introduce Bali Investment Club to the people that don't know of Bali Investment Club. We walk into this event thinking that people have heard of us already. But the short version is Bali Investment Club is, let's say, an angel network. It's a bit of a hybrid. So it's an angel network that operates like a venture capital company. So using the principles and the standards of a venture capital company. And we go around looking for Indonesia's top impact talent. And then once we've spotted them, we actually work with them to bring them to the next level. So the companies that you're going to see today, some of us are already with us. Some of us are joining us very soon. And for us, it's really a journey. And investing isn't about, this just got better. Investing isn't about just giving money to an entrepreneur. It's about giving them support, understanding what they need, what you have to offer, and how you guys can walk together on this journey. So far we have four companies that are walking this road with us. We have Rendria on the second row over there, who's just joined the big family, and one more company before the end of the year. And so the big thing about, you know, bringing people together and running kind of this angel concept is really to get together around a higher purpose. I feel that Indonesia, and it's very clear that Indonesia is on the rise. Indonesia can be, it's itself as a country is becoming a unicorn, and how we support that agenda is by supporting each other. Us, let's say, as foreigners, we have a very simple mission, is these islands give us so much. We get so much from these islands. There's a reason why we're all sitting here today, and that we left our homelands, is because we believe that we can be happier, live more fulfilled lives in Indonesia. And our civic responsibility is, what do we do and what role do we have in that story? How do we participate in making a great country? So thank you to all of you for being here today. Thank you for being part of this journey, whether you're consciously aware of it or not. And now I would like to introduce our panelists. So we have six individuals on your left-hand side that have been very patient, very calm, and I think feeling the heat a little bit. We have lots of refreshments for you, so don't worry. And may I please have a switch to the presentation? Thank you. All right, so we have Mr. Alex Kotyek. Is that how you pronounce it? Alex Kotyek. We have Eric Nathaniel. Please put up your hands so that people can see you. All right. We have Lavinia Yusup. Yes, Lavinia over there with the red dress. We have Leah Sadia. Hello, Leah. And then we have Luke Janssen in the middle with the white shirt. And then finally, we have Stella. Whoop, let's do that. We have Stella joining us. So just to give you a little bit of background, all of these, let's say, angel industry professionals, maybe even gurus in their own spaces, have been following our journey and are all actively involved in the development of some of the startups that you'll be seeing today, and into a whole bunch of startups that are around Indonesia. And so what you can learn from them is get their perspective on how they see the Indonesian market, where they think support needs to come from, where they see opportunity. And something that I'll be inviting everybody to do throughout the rollout of the session is to ask questions, nurture your curiosity. This is really an open space for people to learn from each other. And as you'll see, the format of the pitching, it's very simple. 3 minutes to pitch, 10-slide presentation. Every startup is running against the same template, which makes it very easy for everybody to follow, for everybody to compare themselves in how they think and how they work, and for everybody to give feedback. So once we enter the Q&A, of course, the panelists will be, let's say, leading the questions. But you as the audience, please put up your hand. And there's no stupid question. There's no small question. It's if you are curious, put up your hand. Give us your time. Let us know how you think. So we need to go back onto the PowerPoint presentation director's team. And I'd like us to stay on that for pretty much the next long time. Thank you. Yeah. Is that better? Yeah. Oh, that sounds okay. So we'll keep 5 centimeters on the handheld for everybody that's going to be speaking. And then this is nice and clear. Okay, guys. So we just need to stick to this for the time. Is Indosol the first? Yeah, and then Bukapeo comes next, right? Okay, fantastic. So I'd like to invite Kyle. Kyle is one of the founders and the CEO of Indosol. Most of you knows Indosol. Many of you might already be wearing Indosol. I see that Gil is representing the brand right there. And I'll give you the microphone. You've got the clicker here. And so Kyle got on the big train, or we got on the train with Kyle almost a year ago now, or just over a year, and it's been a ride. I think it's been a hell of a ride. We've all seen a lot of sweat come from the sessions, but then at some point some real magic happened, and we're here on stage, and we'd like to present. Can we have the microphone a bit more stable? And we'd like to present to you Indosol as one of what we call the big heroes, the startups, the entrepreneurs of Indonesia that are making it happen. Kyle is not pitching Indosol, he is sharing his story and the ideas to feel inspired from what they've done and to realize that with your idea, you could be doing the same. So everybody give Kyle a big round of applause.
All right. Thanks so much, Tom. Thanks so much, Bali Investment Club crew. It's been a phenomenal experience so far working with you guys. Really appreciate everything we've done. Let's see, I'm going in the wrong direction. Here we go. So anyways, I'm Kyle. I'm from Indosol. Has anyone here heard of Indosol before? Yeah, sweet. All right, this is going to be easy. So Indosol is a lifestyle and sandal brand here in Bali. And just to tell you a little bit about my story, my dad had been coming to Bali since the early 1980s. So I grew up with a curiosity about Bali, always wanted to come. And in 2004, I finally got my shot, came on a family vacation. And just like pretty much everybody that comes to Bali, I was blown away. You know, it's beautiful here, the culture, the food, the people. Everything is really nice. So I was walking down the street in Seminyak one day, and I had a blowout with my sandals, which, if you don't know what that means, when your thong pulls out of your sandals. And so I was standing there barefoot on the dirty streets of Seminyak, and I needed a solution. I needed a new pair of sandals. So I went shopping, and I was cruising around barefoot, and I found this really nice pair of sandals. And on the sole, it had a tire, and I'd never seen that before. The upper was made out of a natural weave, and then it had a tire on the sole, and I thought that was kind of neat. So I bought the sandals, and then when I got home, I started doing some research about tire pollution. And I found that tires are one of the biggest pollution problems that really nobody knows about. Each year, billions of tires end up in the landfills. They end up clogging our streams and riverways and the land, and they're a very nasty problem. They're also a breeding ground for mosquitoes, which spread nasty diseases like dengue fever and malaria, and they can spontaneously decombust and catch on fire, which, as you can imagine, is very gross and bad for us. So seemed like a good idea to make sandals out of tires. Plus, I really needed an excuse to hang out in Bali. So off I went and, you know, started, you know, by collaborating with the Balinese people here and creating a sandal line. So we started with a full handmade sandal and experimenting with different tires and motorbike tires and car tires with a workshop in Denpasar. And we launched the brand with a $10,000 bank loan and and a lot of energy and expectations. It was, of course, a lot harder than we ever imagined it would be. Making sandals is hard, and when you're going to hand make a product, there's a lot of inconsistencies. But we went for it anyways, and we over the first few years, we got to a volume of 15, 20,000 pair in our original workshop, you know, with these fine people here, and that was great. The product had a lot of charm, but what we realized is that we couldn't make enough volume to support the demand and even save as many tires as we want to. We want to save as many tires as we could and make as big of an impact as we could. So in 2017, we realized we really needed to change. If we were ever going to make this a viable business, never make money, we had to completely rewrite the script. So we went back to the drawing board and designed a whole new line, a whole new breed of sandal called the Essentials, and we created a whole new process. But what we do is partner with an engineer and take tires and then grind it down to a powder and pulverizing the tires and then rebuild it into a mold. So we had a whole new product line called the Essentials with a recycled tire sole. And what this would do would allow us to be able to scale the business, make a lot of sandals, and a bigger difference at the environment's bottom line. Simultaneously, we registered as a B Corp, which is, if you don't know, is basically a certification, which means that we have no one under the age of 18 working in our manufacturing facilities. They're all insured and they're all well taken care of. And that's kind of our stamp of approval. So in 2018, we launched a beautiful new line called the Essentials, and that's what we have today. And, you know, they're 100% waterproof, vegan materials. Each pair has an arch support. We use this amazing material on the upper called Envirofiber. And, of course, with our signature recycled tire soles. Now we have a line for men, women, and kids. And we have these beautiful slides. And then this year we'll be launching an exciting program with 1% for the planet. Where it's a full give back initiative in partnering with really nice nonprofits all around the world, and where we can work with, you know, educational aspect and teaching, you know, anywhere from, you know, here in Bali to other ways in the area in helping to educate what we all need to do with our waste, where it needs to go. And that starts at the educational level, you know, starts in our schools. So it's, you know, what we're a part of. We're, you know, we consider ourselves more than just a sandal brand. We consider ourselves a solutions company. So we're doing what we can to add new and exciting materials into the sandals. This one is called Bloom Algae Foam, comes from the ocean. And our latest release this year is called Sneaker Sole Technology. So there's huge manufacturing facilities in Jakarta, like big brands you've definitely heard of. And these factories make over a million pair of sneakers each month, which turns into hundreds of thousands of defects because they're all not good enough to go to the line. So as a solutions company, we are collecting these sneakers and turning them into our soles, which allows us to add color, and it's really fun. So here you have some of our color sold sneaker sole technology. And last but not least, we have an exciting collaboration with a nonprofit organization here, sorry, for-profit organization called Sunai Watch. And if you haven't heard of Sunai Watch here, they are doing amazing things. Check them out. We're doing our best to work with them and taking the flip-flops they clean out of the riverways and turn them into new flip-flops. Easier said than done. And it's a process. And we're in a development phase, but it's going to happen. And we're also releasing a really nice model called the Adventure. And please come by our shop. We have our own flagship store over here on the way to Echo Beach. And we'll be opening two more shops very soon in Uluwatu and Ubud. So we'd love to see you. And we'll be available for any questions later. So thanks again for your attention. Thanks again for the Bali Investment Club for killing it. Appreciate it.
There you go.
That was spot on. Sweet. So, yeah, if you wanna handle the heat and get off your closed shoes, then please head downstairs, check out what Endosol is doing. Gil, it actually sounds so much better. Okay, so it's really like, try get 10 centimeters on the microphone there. We should have kind of the sponges there, and it'll work out better. Okay, so the next company I'd like to bring up, the whole idea is to make these little inspiration sessions, you know, like kind of short, so that we can give you guys a bit of time to get up and stretch your legs after the pitching. I'd like to invite Mario, one of the co-founders of Bukapeo, to tell a very exciting story about a very fast-moving startup. And please welcome Mario on stage. All right. So you have about like 5 to 7 minutes to tell the story. And then here is your clicker. Big button to click down, small button to click back up. Oh, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Bali Investment Club. Okay. This is good?
You're going to hear the magic voice when you...
Okay. So, right. Hi, everyone. My name is Mario from Bukapeo. Let me tell you a story about Bukapeo. It all started when the pandemic happened. We're no tourists in Bali, and the economy was hit badly. People lost their jobs, businesses, and the lucky one got a salary cut. By the way, during the COVID-19 pandemic, almost 30 million micro and small businesses went bankrupt, and they provide almost 40% of Indonesian employment. Trying to survive, more people started selling food from their home, or so-called home chef, which have been a trend long before the pandemic happened. So they start to selling food from their home to their friends, relatives, and through social media. And this is happening not only in Bali, but also in every cities in Indonesia, such as Jakarta, Surabaya, Medan. Even though they have customers buying their product, it's not enough to cover their living costs. Not to mention the problem they're facing from the lack of capital, complex business process, and inventory waste. Those are the reason why we created Bukapeo, a pre-order community web-based food marketplace platform which can help micro and small businesses to become more effective with less headache and have a larger market. Using our pre-order system, they were able to eliminate their financial risk, maximize their revenue, and simplify their business process. Food delivery and catering service market in Indonesia are huge. It's over $5 billion. In fact, Indonesia is the largest food delivery market in Southeast Asia. That's why, even during -12% economic growth in Bali, as well as pandemic, we were able to generate almost $2.5 GMV for the last 12 months. After the pandemic, last quarter alone, we were able to generate over $1.2 million. What is our USP? We are not just a normal food platform. We empowering our merchant to work and building business together through our reseller and referral program. That's why we believe we can make a difference in the society, and we can make micro and small businesses change the way how they operate to be more effective and efficient. In addition to that, we will enable everyone to become an entrepreneur in just one night, as almost no capital is required. Fun fact, we just launched Bukapeo in Surabaya, and we make 10 times larger compared to when we first started Bukapeo in Bali. That's why we believe our business model can work in every part of Indonesia. Meanwhile, our revenue comes from transaction fee, commission on delivery, and other income. Currently, we are now open round for third funding. If you are interested, you can contact Bali Investment Club. Thank you, everyone.
We lost Mario. Thank you so much, Mario. I never knew you're such a good speaker. That was a beautiful surprise. Thank you for telling the story in a beautiful way. So, yeah, Bukapeo is moving real, real fast. Most of us don't know it because we use GoFood, but the rest of Indonesia is actually going to be using Bukapeo real, real soon. So we're really proud to be part of that story and to show Jakarta what a fast-moving Balinese startup can do. So... So, Henry, you're laughing now, but it's you're up next. So, we'd like to start with a pitching. We'd like to start with a pitching. It's, as I mentioned, pretty simple concept. 3 minutes to pitch, 7 minutes of Q&A. We're going to invite the audience and the panelists to rate each startup at the end of their pitch. And this is a way for you to see the type of work that we do at Bali Investment Club, or the type of work that investors do when reviewing startups to understand if they're a good case or if they need some more work. And at the same time, this is very, very valuable feedback for each of the founders. So we really invite you to fill in. It's a super simple form. You just tap the answers with your thumbs, and this feedback is collected. It's used to actually determine the winner of today. And we also do one-on-one debriefing sessions with the startups. So please share your thoughts. Your feedback is super valuable, and enjoy the show. Henry, would you like to join us on stage? We have you're going to get the QR code in a second. So at the end of each session, we put a big QR code on the screen. You can use your phone to scan it, and then you'll see it takes about like 1 to 2 minutes to get through it. We collect everything, and then we work our magic in the background. Henry, would you like to do a rolling entrance? Okay, so Henry from Scooty, I'm sure you took a look at that little fantastic machine over there. I won't say more. You have 3 minutes, and we will give you probably a hard cut on 3 minutes, so have fun.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Henry, the CEO and founder of Scooty. When I came for the first time to Bali about 15 years ago, I fell immediately in love with the Island of Gods. But I was also shocked about the traffic noise, about the traffic jam, and also about the air pollution. And I got this dream. One day, I want to move to Bali, but not without having a plan how I can help mitigating those problems. And that's how the idea of Scooty got born. So, when I was in Singapore 6 years ago, I tried a stand-up scooter just like this one for the first time. And my mind was immediately blown away. It was so easy to use, it was fun, it was nimble, and most importantly, it was clean and quiet. And then, not a long time later, I started my own e-scooter business, Scooty's Corporation, which developed over the time to Scooty. So, Scooty is providing e-scooters, stand-up e-scooters that are designed for the local road conditions so that they can cope with the local traffic flow. It's a cheap mode of transportation. It will be widely available, and as I said, it's really fun. And interestingly, shared e-scooter business has a really big market. In Indonesia alone, in 2025, the value is estimated to reach $350 million. And what is our special recipe? Well, a roadworthy scooter needs a higher speed, so in this case it's 50 kilometers per hour. We use swappable battery systems with a maximum distance of 60 kilometers per charge, and they're going to get recharged by solar panels. How do we make revenue? We are currently developing our own application, so we're also going to collect big data, and then our customers can rent our scooters from busy spots like restaurants, beach clubs, malls, hotels, and so on. Through the app, that's our main source of revenue, B2C, shopping per minute or monthly subscriptions. But we also plan to make revenues through franchising, so businesses, even cities, can buy our scooters in outside of Indonesia. We plan to distribute in Bali within 1.5 years 5,000 of our scooters as a public means of transportation. And our ambitious vision is to distribute even 100,000 e-scooters in Indonesia within 4 to 5 years. Right now, we already have a successful pilot project in 2 botanical gardens where only 42 scooters are generating 3,000 guests every month. We are also striking out, and we are also different than indirect competitors like motorbike taxis or direct competitors like other e-scooter companies because of our low prices, because we have already 6 years of e-scooter business experience here, and because we have our own e-scooter design, which is really made for the local market. We have also a very multinational and diverse team. Okay, so that's already 3 minutes, I'm sorry. So we are looking in total for $300,000 at pre-seed capital. And if you are interested in really having impact in Bali, if you really want to see traffic jam becoming lower, if you want to reduce air pollution, then Scooty is the right partner. Thank you very much. Okay, Q&A, right?
Can we get I think it's best that you keep your mic and I have mine so that we can do the backwards and forward. Thank you so much for being the first one on stage. Keeping the pace is real tight, just so you know, you did about like 3:30. So that was really, really good. I would like to invite the panelists to ask Henry their questions, and then we'll be looking at the crowds and getting the conversation going. We have about 7 minutes to do that. Cheers. Luke? Yeah, just talk up.
Hi, Luke. I'm in solar panel business since last year, and Scooty has a joint venture with a French solar company here in Bali. That means we can get the solar panels way below the market price, so we expect a return of investment after 3 to 3.5 years with a 30-year warranty for the solar panels. The solar panels will be installed in our central warehouses, so in each area of operation with 5,000 scooters, we're going to have one central warehouse. We can see in our back office when the battery is getting empty, and then our staff is driving out with electric vans to collect the empty batteries, bring them back to the warehouse, and they get charged with solar panels, as I said earlier. However, we are estimating that we can only charge 40 to 45% of our electric vehicle fleet with solar panels because the warehouse space will likely not have enough space to add more solar panels. But that depends ultimately, of course, on the total roof size. Sorry, come again. Well, this is, by the way, an old model. We are currently designing a new model with an automatic sensor-based helmet box for this business model. If you would buy this on the private market, it costs around 17 million rupiah. But we are renting it out through Scooty in the near future for 6 cents per minute. Or you can subscribe per month, and then you pay $42 or 600,000 rupiah. 17, if you buy it, yeah. But our production costs are, of course, lower than that. Stella, go for it. Now, that's a really good question. Now, our specialty is providing scooters that are made for the roads. So they have a higher speed than the kind of scooters that you guys might know from other countries or from grab wheels in the past. Those scooters, they go 50 kilometers per hour. So they can cope with the normal traffic flow among cars and motorbikes. And at the same time, because they're really slim compared to a motorbike, they also have a quick folding system for the handlebar in the front. They can pierce pretty much every traffic jam. And that also helps bigger vehicles to get to move faster around because the whole traffic flow will be faster. Also, they require less parking space, so they will also help with the lack of parking space in busy areas. You're most welcome. Thank you, too. That's a really good question. So first of all, from a safety perspective, because the scooters are way lighter than a motorbike, we have a shorter braking distance, so you can get actually to stop faster. Also, we cap the maximum speed of 50 kilometers per hour. Most serious accidents are happening with a higher speed. We're going to have an automatic helmet box on the rear. In our terms and conditions, we say that you have to wear a helmet. It's also important. We're also going to have staff patrolling around, like offline customer service, to make sure that our customers are following our rules. Besides that, the advantage of a stand-up scooter is that you will be better seen on the road compared to being on a motorbike or bicycle. You can also react faster. And if you're not really riding maximum speed, you even have a chance to jump off in the case of an emergency braking scenario, which you don't have with a bicycle or with a motorbike. So we also expect to actually reduce the number of fatal accidents, which is another advantage. And the other good thing is that those types of scooters, they are already tested since more than 5 years, even on bigger roads, Sunset Road, Jalan Bypass Ngurah Rai, Jakarta, Jalan Sudirman, and so on. So we know that it works, we know that it is convenient, but the perception that you're right, that's a big problem. Because especially Indonesians, but also Westerners, they're used to travel in unnatural, unhealthy position, which is sitting, and then they feel safe. But that's not, this is just perception in many cases, you know. So what we have to do is we have to go large scale. We have to see more people on the road using the product. And we want to make that happen by putting the product in busy spots, by making campaigns with influencers. We have also a female racing team in Java, which will also be good to promote roadworthy e-scooters. I mean, an e-scooter racing team. And we have to offer low prices so that everyone can at least try it, you know. That's our approach for the issue. Thank you. Yes, please. Well, we have currently 42 scooters in the Botanical Garden of Bedugul and Botanical Garden of Bogor. That's correct, yeah. Okay, so the target market is definitely not the parks. We are mainly doing that to have a positive cash flow and to please potential investors. It's not our vision because if you put any kind of electric vehicle into a park, you have no positive impact. You're not replacing cars or motorbikes, you're not reducing energy consumption, so it's not what we want. So Scooty is committed. Scooty is committed to only put maximum 12.5% of our entire fleet in secluded tourist areas like zoos, parks, and so on. And there we usually use scooters like this, but with lower speed because we don't need to drive 50 kilometers per hour in a zoo, for example, right? But there we can charge higher prices and just 6 cents per minute. We have different concepts there. We have mini tours, daily rental, hourly rental, and we can do it even without an application, which saves us cost. But for the main concept, for the public transportation concept for which we are raising money now, of course we need an application to collect the data, to see where our scooters are, to maintain them properly, and so on. So the first $300,000 will be used to finish our new e-scooter design based on this one. It was a swappable battery system, not yet with GPS and helmet box, that comes in the next phase. And those first scooters, 120 in total, they will get deployed to two new tourist areas, one large island in Lombok, where we have an exclusive partnership and can charge way higher prices. No other vehicles will be allowed there. Plus 20 scooters will go to South Jakarta into a new park area. And then we have even more positive cash flow. Then we want to go into the seed round, and then we want to go big with our public transportation company.
All right, all right. We have time for one last question. Alex.
Thank you, too.
Hear me? Oh, there we go.
You might want to be, yeah, maybe stand up and just...
That's a great question. Thank you very much, Alex. All right, so the question is, how are we dealing with naughty customers who put their scooters wherever they want, create new issues, if they're suddenly on the road or on a bicycle lane? So we are not using this free-floating concept that you might know from America for good reasons. We don't have the kind of public space here in Indonesia that we find in America and Singapore or in Western countries. We have a so-called dockless geofence mobility station system, which means we have fixed parking spots, which we call mobility stations, which will be in front of our partners' properties, again, like restaurants, malls, beach clubs, and so on. With those partners, we can, of course, also do cross-marketing so that there will be a mutual benefit. And our customers have to rent the scooters from those spots, and they also have to return them to one of those spots, but of course not to the same. So if we have a station here, for example, another one at Finn's Recreation Club, and the customer can just park the scooter at Finn's Recreation Club and doesn't have to return it somewhere else. We're also going to have a VIP or business package. Those customers are allowed to park the scooter wherever they want, but even those customers have to return it after 10 p.m., before 10 p.m. So we're going to have fixed operational hours, like a bus or train system from 7 a.m. to 10
p.m.
Henry,
yeah. I'm going to ask you to wrap it up.
All right. That actually already answers the question, I hope. Thank you, too. Thank you, everyone.
Warm applause for Scooty. Thank you. Thank you for being the first on stage. That's always the toughest one to get out. Yeah. You can leave the bike here if you want, or you can maybe ride out. Wheelie. So for those of you who maybe did it during the Q&A session, thank you for you know, doing your scorecard ratings. For those who haven't, we're going to give you maybe just 1 minute to do so. As we mentioned, the idea is to collect as many views and many opinions as possible that we can collate and help give the Scooty team some valuable feedback. I'm going to give you just less than 1 minute to do so before I invite the second startup on stage. And then what we will do next is, as you saw, we had it, but just so that you remember, is to do your rating of the startup while we're doing the Q&A. That way we can move on to the next session, and then we can essentially reach the break and give you guys some opportunity to refresh yourselves and to stretch your legs. You want to keep it there? No, you can. Can you do a burnout? Okay. Are we good to go with the second presentation? Fantastic. All right. So we'd like to invite... Oh, can we move back to the presentation screen, please? Thank you. All right. I'd like now to call up Rendria, founder and CEO of Magalava. Here we go.
Enjoy. So how do I do this?
Yeah, click through there on the big one, back on the small one.
Okay, cool.
There we go.
Cool.
I want to give you 3 minutes. Try look this way. I'll give you the 1 minute timer. And then we do seven minutes Q&A. Can we just last thing quickly? Can we please make sure that the microphones are working for the panelists so that the audience is able to hear the panelists' questions?
Yes. Got it.
Yeah, Stella, are we good? Let's give it a little whirl. Technical team, could we please get the second microphone working? Otherwise, we've already got one with Stella, and that's a good start. Okay. Rendria, right. The floor is yours. Okay. 3 minutes start now.
All right. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Rendria. I'm CEO and founder of Magalarva. So we produce sustainable feed for animal farmers by converting food waste. But to simplify it, basically, I'm a fly farmer. So approximately 42,000 tons of food waste are being wasted every single day in Indonesia. And there's no solution around it at this point. Secondly, two of the most consumed meat in the world is chicken and fish. Chicken and fish rely so much on animal feed, and two of the most abundant raw materials is fish protein and soybean protein. But it is consumed at an unsustainable rate. It's causing overfishing and deforestation. So it's actually a very big problem. It's a $3.7 billion worth of problem. So this is where we come in. So we replace the existing animal feed with mugga larva feed, which is more sustainable, stable, and the price is decreasing because we don't exploit any nature. And most importantly, it's 100% scalable. So how do we do it? We use black soldier fly. There should be a picture there over there, actually. But basically, black soldier fly is an insect, and we use black soldier fly to produce black soldier fly-based animal feed by converting food waste. So we collect food waste from hotels, restaurants. We produce animal feed from that, and we put it back to the food chain. So after we harvest the larva, we derive the products to become these products. So we have our protein powder, we have whole dried larva, and our current focus product is our shrimp feed. So our current business model looks like this. So we collect the food waste from factories, hotels, restaurants, and we charge them for it, and we produce the animal feed, and then we sell the animal feed to farmers, to feed mills, etc. So over the next 2 years, we're going to focus on the shrimp industry, where we're going to focus on our shrimp supplement product, which is our first steps towards building awareness towards the shrimp market, shrimp farmers, and best of all, is actually our highest margin product. And over the past 6 months, we have been growing this sales over 2x every quarter. And after that, by 2024, we're going to launch an economy product called Magma Meal, which is a cheap protein powder to penetrate the aquaculture market and the poultry market, which is another $4 billion protein market. Sorry. So, WineSec in nutrition
technology. You have 1 minute.
WineSec nutrition technology are all our competitors around the world. But one thing that they don't have is Indonesia, the climate of Indonesia, and the food waste elimination, as we are an expert of doing so. And I'm going to skip over this. Over this year, we already have revenue of $123,000. We're projecting a healthy and growth and exponential growth over the next 3 years by focusing on the shrimp industry, whereas we have a very sexy product market fit and a very sexy market to actually penetrate. So we're raising $300,000 to increase our sales force to focus on the shrimp industry. And by doing so, we're going to maximize our production and also reducing our cost of production by 30%. So just doing the benchmark around the world.
Time's up, Randy.
Okay, so cool. Okay, time's up. And so if you want to join us, join me to revolutionize the food waste and animal feed industry. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We've got about 7 minutes now to do the Q&A, so don't worry if you didn't get to explain everything. Yeah. This is the time to do so. Eric, I see that you'd like to maybe open.
Go ahead.
Want this? Oh, antenna up in the air. Thank you.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yep. Hi, thanks for the presentation. I would like to ask, because this BSF product is now practically very popular.
Yeah,
besides
yeah.
you, there are also cottage industries, small farmers or home industries also producing BSF.
Yeah.
Not very commercialized, not very industrialized. How do you see this kind of player when in your competition?
Okay, so the plan, thank you for the question actually, Eric. So the plan for us is actually, so the idea about black soldier fly is we have to beat the existing animal protein. But the existing animal protein, as I said, is unsustainable. But at the end of the day, the price is still very sensitive in this industry. So if we don't have the capacity to actually beat the pricing of the existing protein, which is now the fish protein and soybean protein, it's not going anywhere. So all these players, which is all the smaller players, like small farmers, like I see that it's not actually possible for them to actually beat the performance of like a very high commercialized factory from in terms of like efficiency and everything. Because for us, we have been doing this since 2017. We're pretty much we're pretty confident that we are one of the most sophisticated players in the industry. Like, how do I say that? It's because the efficiency of our production compared to the numbers that we get from these farmers are very, very high compared to them. Like, for instance, there's a lot of things like the density of per meter square production, there is a mortality rate, there's a hatching rate for the eggs, there's a recycling rate, there's a breeding rate, all of these kinds of stuff. And if you compare the analogy of, say, like poultry farms or like shrimp farms, there has to be the players that actually has the best breed. There has to be players that has the best method to actually educate all these farmers and try to actually partner up with all these farmers to actually, hey, use our breed or like our DNA or our genes or whatever. And in that sense, they will have the best. They will have the best yield by using this very much sophisticated breeds and sophisticated raw materials. Thank you very much.
Hello, how's it going?
Hi.
I just invested in a similar company in Thailand. And how are you connected to the so your big suppliers is the sort of going around the hotels and getting the food waste? How are you connected to anyone who does more, like has a lot more waste, like one of the big companies? Do they exist in Bali and Indonesia, and do you have relationships with them? And my second part is that's your sort of supply, and then when you're selling it, you're selling it to shrimp farmers. Are they on island as well, or where else are they?
Okay, so thank you for the question. So first question is, where do we get our supply, basically, and like who's our major player, right? So we get our supplies from practically everywhere we can get. Like, for instance, now we have a contract with Indomilk, and we have contract with Chimori as well to process their expired milk and the milk waste and whatever and whatnot. So those are our big players. But actually, what makes us unique is currently now we're working with the scavenger from the landfills, basically. We're actually incentivizing them to supply to us the specific food waste that we want. And we actually empower them, like, because for instance now all the scavengers are currently trying to do is they scavenged all the unorganic waste, like all the plastic waste from the water bottles, water plastic bottles and whatever. But we incentivize them to actually, hey, we want this type of food waste, and we will act, basically we will pay you for it. So those are the type of a model of supply that we're currently doing. And that's actually is our most scalable one, because I think at the end of the day, if we give economical incentives there, basically we can actually grow that, like rather than hoping for somebody else to actually give us the revenues to charge.
Do you think that'll be a limiting factor? What I really liked was the idea of people paying you to take away their food waste. That was awesome. Do you think supply is going to be an issue? Where do you see the bottlenecks? And when you scale up,
The supply is definitely not our issues. Yeah. The production is definitely not our issues, actually, because but our current issues is we're trying to penetrate more and more to the market. That's why we focus now on the shrimp industry, because the shrimp industry is more like it's not a smallholder farmers type of business. It's more like a businessman, like investors, like these big players having these farms and whatnot. So that's why they're more open to these kinds of solutions, these kinds of innovations. Okay, I want to pay for a performance rather than like, are you cheaper than the existing one? Mm-hmm. So it's a bit different than the poultry market or the catfish or the tilapia, whatever. That's why we're penetrating the shrimp industries because of that.
In Bali, where are the shrimp guys?
The shrimp guys is all over Indonesia. Like, the biggest part is in East Java. East Java is one of the big parts. Sulawesi also is very growing. Bali is also pretty good. Lombok is actually growing, and Sumatra is actually pretty big as well.
Great. No, thanks.
Yeah.
Hey, great presentation, and I really like the product. The thing that struck me when I was reading your deck is that you valued the company at $2 million currently?
Yeah.
Okay, and what was the thinking behind the 2 million? Because when you present and when you talk about the space that you're in, you sound like a much bigger company. It sounds like a much bigger opportunity, and I'm wondering if you're undershooting the valuation. Can you walk through the numbers a little bit there?
So I think the thinking behind it is we're confident in our abilities to actually, you know, strike a bigger valuation. But I think at this point we don't want to raise too much, because I think that's one of the ways for us to not be much careful company, and I think the valuation makes the investment actually is going to be sexier and is going to be much more investable, because you know we see that investors usually want a certain percentage to actually interested in joining in. So that's why first we come up with a how much money do we need for the next 18 to 24 months, and then we see that how can we really realistically raise the money on that.
I don't know what I did. Oh, it's back.
Last question. Thank you.
Thank you. No, I understand your perspective very much, and I hope I'm not hogging the panel's time here. but one thing to consider, and forgive me, this is coming through me, not, you know, I can't stop it. If I wanted to present you to an Archer Daniels Midland, which is like one of the largest food processing, food manufacturing companies in the world, you might be excluded from that conversation because you're so small. Right, and let me just back up for a second. They have a innovation lab, and they're looking for companies like you.
Okay.
Right, so you may want to take a look at the valuation and think bigger. Just that's how it's striking me.
All right.
I see high potential. That's right. Another way of saying it.
Thank you.
All right, Alex. Thank you so much for your depth of questions there, Rendria. You did real, real well. We struck the 10-minute mark right on board. For the audience and the panel, I hope that you took the time to give your ratings to the Magalava team. Thank you so much for joining us and for flying into Bali. I would now like to invite a company that we've actually known for quite a little while. And I believe it's not the first time that you'll be presenting in an event related to BIC. I'd like to invite Daniel, founder and CEO of SmartMates. And Pauline. All right. Here is your microphone. You guys are gonna need to share because I have to, it's just lined through my back. So I'm gonna sit here. 3 minutes to pitch. I give you the one finger for 1 minute left, and then I give you the cutoff so that we can start with the Q&A. Cool. Okay. Enjoy.
Thanks, Tom. Hi, everybody. My name's Dan. I'm the founder of SmartMates, and this is our general manager, Pauline. SmartMates guide companies through. We guide companies through their digital transformation journey. So we engineer software that helps automate business processes so companies can improve productivity and efficiency. And it's something that every company worldwide needs. In the last 12 months in Bali, from our little office in Umalas, we've built 6 billion rupiah in revenue, and we're just getting started.
You might be wondering how we can generate this revenue. So we currently charge $89 per hour, which is more than 50% cheaper than our competitors. We work fully remote, which allows us to serve 6 different countries from Bali. And we also have the potential to quickly expand to more platforms.
Thank you. So in our office, we have the expertise to use technology to perform complex business processes. And what that does for companies is it allows humans to focus on higher value work.
One of our superpowers is our business model. Our clients pay upfront in full for a pack of consulting hours. Our process includes a pay-as-you-use system with balance and top-up, and a transparent and honest reporting with our weekly smart met statements. We are currently building a marketing strategy around content creation and organic traffic.
Thank you. In July this year, we, Tom, 1 minute, yeah. We spent $62 million on paid digital marketing, and we generated $720 million in revenue from that alone. That's a 12 times return on our digital marketing spend.
We currently have 30 team members. Our management team is a mix of foreigners and Indonesian talents. On the screen, you can see Nita and Riz. We were two of our first employees and are now on leadership role. This demonstrates our mission to upskill Indonesian talent into world-class IT leaders. We've built a financial model based on our current figures and also on the expected growth based on our roadmap. As you can see, we expect the margin to sustainably grow each quarter and to reach higher figures starting 2025.
You can see that we have a very exciting roadmap where we're launching new offers and scaling to new markets, culminating in what we see as a trade sale exit in 5 years' time. To support the roadmap, we're raising $1.9 million and we'll use the funds to grow our talent and retain them and invest in our growth strategy. So we'll be happy to respond to any of your questions and share more of our story. Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much, Daniel and Smart Makes Team. You guys have now, 7 minutes for the Q&A. And for the audience, I just got this question asked. Yes. Everybody is allowed and invited to vote, so please share your views and help create feedback for our founders. Thank you so much.
Hi, I'd like to ask some questions actually. How do you plan on acquiring constant stream of talents into your team?
We actually constantly recruiting. So we are recruiting two kind of profile, mostly fresh graduate, teach them how to learn about business automation and digital transformation. And we also more experience profile.
We just see unlimited talent in Indonesia. We're blown away by the talent, not just in Bali, but we're bringing people in from Surabaya, Jakarta, and all sorts of other cities. And we just see endless talent pool here. That's our biggest strength, really. Does that answer the question?
Yeah. Hi, I for 12 years I ran a company that did sort of transformations. It's a nice business to be in. I'm wondering what your company is doing. Do you have a piece of software you've written, or do you have a business process analysis process that you follow with techie guys? Like, how much of your revenue is bespoke to each company, and how much of a software company are you really, or how much of a services company are you really? Because the game when I was doing it was we were services, but you had to pretend to be software because, of course, you want those multiples. But to what extent are you battling with that equation?
So we are a software consulting company. We don't own a piece of software yet. It's part of our strategy to also develop some in-house software. We currently are also authorized partner. So we are planning to expand to more platforms, so to more partnership with other business software companies. Mm-hmm. So we usually sell services around, mostly around Zoro for now. Mm-hmm. And that's it. Does it reply?
That could be a fantastic world to be in. And the only thing I would say is everyone in that business sort of sees the allure of a product that you can scale like Atlassian. But I've always seen it crash and burn. I think if you stick to what you're good at and scale that model, there's plenty of exits in that area, and you can even get sort of 2 or 3 times revenues if you're doing a good job of it. But I've always seen companies crash and burn when they try and go product or services, right? Stick to which one you are and you'll get some nice growth. I mean, you can't argue with the revenues you've got, so right, that's fantastic. But I've seen some two-headed monsters, and it's, you know, I was one of them, and I thought, yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to be the one guy, and we never did, right, in 12 years. So it's an interesting business, but we should have a chat afterwards, and I'll tell you all the mistakes I made so you don't have to make them.
Thank you for the advice.
No more questions?
So I'm wondering if you consider, so just like Luke, I was a little bit confused exactly what part of your service is automation and what part is consulting, because on the slide with the team, you speak a lot about your consulting experience, and consulting and automation are two vastly different things that need different sets of skills and so on. So I'm wondering, how much do you consider your services to be a competitor to, for example, UiPath, which is a decacorn, Europe's first decacorn in SaaS automation, and what would be the competitive advantage, right, of working with you guys compared to a company like that? And just one very small suggestion would be to turn in any pitch, to turn all of your valuations, numbers, asks for investment, and so on into USD. It's the global language of investment. So most of us are not Australian, and we don't have the time or so to do the conversions when we're looking at a slide. Just a small suggestion.
Thanks for that. Can you just explain what that company does? Because I haven't heard of the one in Europe to compare.
So they are basically automating business services, business processes, just like what I understand you guys are doing, right?
With their own software or using other software?
Yes, their tagline is basically a robot or an algorithm for every person. So basically servicing yourself, helping yourself to this sort of technologies that help you automate things that shouldn't be done by humans, I guess.
I think the opportunity that we see is there's so many existing softwares already. There's softwares that can automate everything that's already been built. But the problem as a business owner and in management of a business is you don't know how to use those softwares for your business. So we really see our strength as a consulting company taking the existing softwares and make it really simple and easy to automate your business. And we do it in such an efficient way at SmartMates through our, you know, our secret sauce or our methodologies, our systems and our processes. Effectively, when we jump on Zooms with our leads that inquire to us, we deliver them a quote and they pay, you know, $5,000 or $10,000 in our bank account within a week or two. So that's our formula, I think, more focusing on the services consulting, and we're doing it really well with the talent in Indonesia and letting the other companies build the software at this stage.
All right, we have time for one more question. Alex.
Hey, yeah, great. Really appreciate your presentation, and I know how hard the work it is that you're doing. I did it for a couple of decades myself in management consulting.
Could you talk up a little bit?
Is that better? Okay, perfect. So the one thing I wanted to ask you was, what makes you different in your own words? Because when I was reading your deck, it sounded like what came out was lowest cost provider, right? And that's a slippery slope, as we all know. And if you are going to be lowest cost provider, then how are you going to compete with China and India and other jurisdictions that are also pretty low cost? So, you know, you guys come across personably really strong, and I know that there's great potential there, and I'd just love to hear in your own words, like deck material aside, what makes you different?
You know, the truth to that is our spirit. We are low cost, but $89 an hour worldwide is low cost. And because we're in Indonesia, we can benefit from the lower wages here. So the margins are there. But then when we have clients connect with us on Zooms, they haven't met a company like us. We're very bright, very intelligent, very savvy, fast. And you know,
So your culture's a differentiator.
It's definitely the culture. And it's obviously because we're in Bali and we're all loving every day.
And you know, part of our passion, Pauline and I, is transforming Indonesian talent, and so that drives us as well. And we jump on Zooms with UK, Australia, New Zealand, Singapore, and all these graduates are doing these Zoom calls in perfect English, perfect emails, and perfect engineering. So I think the clients just feel that it's really our culture and our spirit, and we're very efficient. Pauline's a very efficient GM. Yeah.
All right, Dan, Pauline, thank you so much. Nice to have you on stage again. Thank you very much for your Q&A. I feel that just in the sake of time, and this is a message going to the founders that are speaking next, I would really invite you to say it with less words. We tend to get carried away quite quickly, and just to give yourself more time for more questions and for you to be more relaxed, just speak with less words when you're presenting. Just so you know, the panelists have your decks on their phones already, so they've gone through the content. And give yourself the time to just get through all your slides before you see the 1 minute or the crossed arms. I'd like now to invite Rice, who is the founder of ButMe.ai. Oh, yes, it's on.
Hello. Just before, I just need everybody's consent because I'm doing the most sexiest pitch you've ever seen. So the pictures could be sensitive. Is it all right? Is everybody above 18? It's okay. Got it. Okay, let me just start. Cool. Right, my name is Rice. I'm here to tell you about the story of how we start this project. So, ladies and gentlemen, sexiest things alive. Did you know that I clean up your bad romance so the economy's nation can flourish? And gender-based violence. This is what's happening every single day, and my foundation has been doing this since 2018. Guess what? Gender-based violence and bad romances can include to up to 16.3 trillion dollars by 2030, according to our Ministry of Health. And that includes decreasing quality in human capital, and as well as high rise in the long-term personal health costs. There's PTSD, sexual traumas, sexual health, inflammation, cancer, all those things are very expensive. So we can focus on the 46 million potential, but come on, let's just focus here. When there's 23 million girls that's going to have this bad experience. You don't want that to happen to your sister, your daughter, or your wife, because I am a counselor for sexual traumas. And that can happen because at least 52% of women has sexual traumas before the age of 16. So you gotta process that, otherwise your wife will not have sex with you. So, BubMe, that's our solution to cater to teens and youth to combat this very hard issues with a kawaii factor, because then it's stigmatized. No one talks about this at all. No one knows how to go and get the SOS. Like, where can I get help if I get a dick pic or someone's going to scam me with porn revenge? How are we going to do it? Tamagotchi is an old game, school game. I'm sure you guys know about it. And we keep on coming back to Tamagotchi because you kind of have to nurture it. You have to feed it. And my perspective is the metaphor of my users to take care of the pet and reminds them to take care of themselves. That's the prompt. By asking them the right questions, it's actually a psychological factor to help them feel more resilient and better and get a courageous, more aspect in terms of their puberty, first puberty adolescent time when it's very vulnerable. So I want to focus on that. Our main revenue stream will be based on subscription form and B2B. But what I want to focus is that our users will get cash perks. Why? We want to achieve herd immunity. And by that, I mean herd electronic immunity against gender-based violence and online harassment. By putting this as an instant perk, we would help all girls, and of course boys in the future, to actually help each other and have a better and kinder, safe community. And you don't see that in social media at all. There's no kind of social media these days. So what our GTM strategy is about is to actually do a pop culture approach. No one reads in Indonesia.
Rice, you have 1 minute.
Yep. I can give you all about the webinars, but no. We're going to do a web series production like Sex and the City for girls and moms. And that's going to be an implementing, changing mindset from the cultural perspective itself. We make the most fun in the freemium section. There is wasa.ai and there is Clue and period calendar in the series end, but we make it most fun. Why do we make it most fun? Because my team knows what's happening in the next generation of growing pains. I come from the design and death psychology background, and my team, my advisors as well, it comes from many different angles for us to make this into a more holistic approach to sexual victims. We seek 850,000 to develop our platform and technology and introduce our Bummy product. And in by 2025, we hope to have 500 club members and actually create change. Well, girls can, and girls can survive in the digital age of all these dick pics and tit pics. Anyways, my name is Rice. I'm the Chief Empath Officer, and we bub you all. Thank you very much.
All right. Big well done, big well done. We have a couple of minutes for the Q&A.
I want to ask you, so can you explain me the product, right? Like, what is the product and also the features that's going to be there? So is it an app? Is it a web browser, web app or whatever? And then what's the features? And then if you say that it's going to solve your problems, how do you going to measure that?
Okay, so thank you very much for your question. It's Leah, right? Great. My product is first by gamification. So Tamagotchi is basically going to be an app for a while. It's going to be beta. It's going to be this pet, which they can start to do a design on their own. And that pet is going to start to trigger all the different questions. And it's like, I need to eat. I mean, that's one way to interact. And all these girls will come back to their app and start feeding them and nurturing them and all that. But the whole point is that the questions that we actually tell them and all the different needs is by educating them through the gamification without them knowing. So the communication and the gamification is actually teaching them how to be resilient in, you know, digital age. I can't give them a textbook. So the way that they would learn, sort of like in a more informal way, is the communication with the games, if that makes sense.
And then can you measure the impact that you're looking for?
Right. So the impact that we're looking for is definitely more on the qualitative and cultural side. What I mean by herd immunity, which is a herd electronic immunity, is when I create a strategic sisterhood within the app, we would have our own community, which is member-based, and I do have an MVP 2 years ago for online harassment. And with that growth itself, if the girls start to protect each other nicely, and we have moderators as well, and they can get perks if the comments are approved, then that in itself would actually help each other online. Because during COVID, when you are under, you know, domestic-based violence or, you know, in toxic relationships, you can't get help. You can't get out. The only way is community-based, which is something that we usually do in sexual trauma healing. But then during COVID, no one can even find a, you know, offline community. So I have to translate that community and feel it online.
Hi. So I actually have in my team a bunch of young girls who, as you described, have gone through some of the horrific things that you mentioned. And to the point that their mental health sometimes is really
gallow.
Bad.
Yeah, it's the gallow economy.
I think like it's much worse than that. To the point that they need month-long breaks from work because they're just so traumatized. Like there's serious, severe PTSD. In this kind of like more extreme case, are you doing anything rather? Because like this gamification, this Tamagotchi thing seems very pretty lightweight general education.
Okay, thank you so much for the question, and I do handle that. So my foundation has been handling that for 2018, and we thought the problem has not been, like, it's not stopping, it's getting worse during COVID. So I had to think of how to create a startup to scale and address it even faster, because we only have 21 volunteers doing this on a real basis. So what I'm trying to do is, like, even though it looks like a game, we do have the helpline service, we have the journals. So basically, the Antina chat, which is my AI, Antina, so that's the pun, is also connected to like a telehealth. There's legal, there's counselors, there's psychologists. Why do we need legal? It's because if they have an evidence and they would like to put report it to the police, they're able to actually consult whether, hey, you know, I've got this compromising picture, I would like to save myself. And they would need to get a legal team. So we would have that behind the scenes. And that's the helpline service.
Could we pass the mic to Lavinia?
So, first of all, a fantastic idea and a problem that I think it takes the whole village, right, to tackle, and projects like yours are definitely going that direction. I'm wondering, your target audience is very susceptible to or very sensitive to specific types of marketing, right? To the cool factor, to other peers are doing it, you know, I'm going to do it as well. How do you plan to tackle that, right? How do you plan to make this cool, to make this something that friends recommended to each other and so on?
Great. Thank you so much for your question. First of all, the go-to-market strategy, which I explained before, I'm going to use a web series or practically a girls, like HBO Girls, Sex and the City. In the 90s, Sex and the City was the epitome, and until today, it's still very relevant. In Indonesia, because people watch through TVs only then with the screens, and they would understand, oh, the culture has changed. I didn't know that. Because most moms and dads in the era today, especially in Asia Pacific, they would not realize, you know, my daughter's still a virgin, you know, like, my daughter's okay, she's a good girl, she doesn't do all these things. And my target audience, or basically my FGD, is 14-year-olds, who's like, yeah, my friend has a sugar daddy, and she's 14. And like, can you tell me more about this? So there's a whole, I don't know, there's a whole bunch that the parents wouldn't understand, or they deny. And the kids are just like, you know, this is part of our lives, because it's a netizen world. So we would have to use a visual pictogram and popular culture to, like, to at least it daughters and moms connection first, and actually heal through that, because obviously I can't do Sex and the City in Indonesia, but it's that epitome of pop culture that became the zeitgeist, and until today is still reference for females. Thank you.
All right, we have time for one last question.
Bryce, thank you for tackling this very important problem. Seriously, it's a. I have a 15-year-old daughter, and I know what they struggle with, and I've actually done some of the research in an effort to help her as well navigate the social media aspect in particular. What's not clear to me, and this is for, like, coming from a place of love and me wanting to help you, is what is the product? Like, is the product an online coach experience? Is it a game? Is it like can you just help me? And maybe it's because I'm a, you know, an older guy, and I'm clearly not the target market. Can you help me understand the product just a little better?
Okay, Alex, are you familiar with Animal Crossing?
I am not. Maybe that's why.
Yeah. I'm sure some of you guys play Animal Crossing during COVID, I think. So it's technically a virtual world. It's like you having avatars to walk. So it's basically a metaverse before everyone became a metaverse. Then
Okay. That's
the cultivation of having a virtual loving community from there. But using avatars, you know why? Because I want it to be anonymous. No one's going to judge each other. And there's no real names involved. So that's how we protect each other.
So it's a virtual pet, or is it a whole metaverse environment?
It's going to be by 2024.
Which one, a pet or an environment?
First, it's going to be a pet. That's the beta launch. So Okay. It's just a simple sort of like a one-on-one session first.
Yeah.
And it takes money, again, to develop the whole BWork world.
Okay. And then eventually it'll be an ecosystem and a metaverse and a full immersive environment where you walk your dog in different theme parks, as an example. Or
except it's them. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right. Rise. I just want to say you're a rock star. That was just so cool. I haven't seen somebody with so much sass and talking about such a sensitive subject before. So please, big round of applause for Rice.
Thank you.
Okay, so we've actually gone past the halfway mark of our event, and I'd like to invite you to take a quick leg stretcher, that's called, yeah? About like 5 to 10 minutes before you get up, because I know as soon as you say you take a break, you get up immediately. I'd like to invite Gil on stage. I think I'm just going to keep it at that. Gil?
I love that. Hi, guys. Hi. It's really good to be here again at their third event. There's a lot of familiar faces and a lot of new faces. How many people are here for the first time? How many people came here either alone or just with one person they know? Yeah, and how many of you are currently sitting next to that one person you know? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So my job at a lot of these events is to see if I can facilitate today. One of the lovely ladies branded me as a networking genie. I've never been branded that yet. But I do love to manifest connections for people, cross-pollinations, people learning how to ask for help, advice from each other. There's a lot of people here that are talented, and you have a project, it doesn't mean that you can't help someone else. It doesn't mean that you're not here in a position of please, please, please help me because I'm the talent, I'm the entrepreneur, I'm the startup, I need help, I need money. You could also be in a position of, you know, what do you do and why do you do what you do and who would you like to meet? And what I'd like to suggest right now during the break is for you to maybe explore asking people for advice on who you need to meet. And it's not just I need to meet an investor with a lot of money. Maybe I need to meet some mentors. Maybe I need to meet specifics. I'm looking to meet a mentor right now who can help us understand how to get a presentation and a better structure and how to meet maybe the right people that have some money. And instead of telling people, if people ask you what you do, don't say I'm an entrepreneur. Don't say I'm a consultant. Don't give them one-word answers. Try to give them a few answers more of I help companies to automate their business in a way that makes it easier and they have more time to spend with their kids. You know, like little things like that could maybe help. At the end of today's event, we're going to do a very interactive activity with you. It's a networking session where you don't just get to go to the back and randomly talk to maybe great people that you need to meet right now, but maybe you're randomly talking to people you know. But we'll do some interactive games and exercises like we did at the first event, which was very successful because it helped you meet a few, maybe a handful of people that you truly need to meet today. I believe people came here today, one, to be inspired by who's pitching, but I really believe you came here today to maybe meet someone that shares your values. Maybe they need to meet you right now. Maybe you need to listen to them because of what they've gone through. How many investors in this room? So I'd like to ask you all to see yourselves as investors because there's no one here that's a kid, which means you've gone through experience in life. You can invest your time. Giving an hour of your time to someone else who's just starting a business, who's just starting a business in Bali, you're able to invest your time. Yeah, and even if you're not an investor, if you're looking, how many of you are looking for investors? So what's going to happen with 95% of the people you meet that have money? They will not give you money. 95% will not give you money. What could be really cool is you can tell them, listen, I understand maybe you're not interested in my company, but there's two of my friends who have really incredible companies that match more of the profile of what you're looking for. Do you mind if I make an introduction? Now, that has really worked out for me. That you could see that as karmic partners, help others raise money. If you're not going to get this guy's money, 95% of investors you talk to are not going to give you money. That's okay. You got to work the numbers a little bit, find the right ones, you know, get introduced to the right ones. Introduce them to someone else in this room today. So if you are going to talk to an investor or someone that could really help you in collaboration, but maybe you don't see the immediate point with you, try to put yourself in a position instead of like, let me sell, let me buy. Let me buy some people's talent today without actual money. Like, tell me more about your business. Let me maybe, who would you like to meet today sort of thing? And I can guarantee you, being a magician of networks, that a lot of the people that you need to meet right now in business, whether it's a co-founder, whether it's an investor, a mentor, are in this room today. So ideally, you're here until the end of the day, so we'll get to have a little bit more interaction. But right now, as you go to the back, they told me they put some water in the back, so you don't have to go downstairs for water. Yeah, we put some more water for them. Guys, Tom, yeah. Tom, there's water here now. They don't have to go downstairs, so there's water here. Yeah, he's giving me a thumbs up there. So try to stay in this space itself. We don't want to lose half the room that's going to go downstairs because you want some snacks. The guy put some healthy chips for you guys as well. I think for the next break, we'll get them some cucumbers or something to give you guys a little bit happy energy. But stay in this room. Consider to ask people why they do what they do and what help or advice they might need. And take that conversation to anywhere. And if I can help you in any way, again, they labeled me as a networking genie today, so I'll be here to help as much as possible, especially at the end of today. Thank you, guys. Enjoy your break. How much money do they have? How much time do they have?
About 5-10 minutes max, literally, a little leg stretcher. We've got fresh water at the back. I'm going to bring the coconut water here. We've got some snacks. So just loosen up, get comfy, and then we've got about 40 minutes of session before we move downstairs for the final leg of the event. Thank you so much for joining us so far, and Gil.
But definitely get up and stretch your legs and leave your phones in your pockets, please, yeah? Don't get up and get on your phone, please. Get up, look around you, smile at some people. Go congratulate the entrepreneurs. Go talk to the moderators. Have fun.
Hello, hello. Okay, fantastic. I'd like to invite everybody to slowly but surely make their way back to their seats. We're going to be picking up the session with an inspirational talk and potentially controversial talk, perhaps controversial talk for the typical Canggu crowds, with Hugo Messer. So please, everybody, find your way back to your seats. Thank you. Okay. Can everyone at the back hear me? Can I get a show of hands from the back? Alex, we've got you. Do you think the people behind you can hear me? Would you mind herding them back in? Henry, we'd like to bring everybody back to the front, please. My dear partners, I need your help to do the same. If you can help me herd people in. Thank you. All right. How's it, Tristan? Good. All right, Faye. I'd like you to come back to the front. Hi, Dinda.
Hi.
Welcome. Please find your way to the front. We're trying to get the session going. We've got Hugo is going to be speaking next. Thank you. All right. Yes. Round two. Thank you. Please.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. How's it, guys?
Hey,
Hugo. How you doing?
You.
Good. Okay. Well, whatever. all good. Sweet. We're starting the second round of the session. We've got Hugo making a small chat, and then I think it'll be you on stage. So just stay close to the front.
More to the front.
Yeah, we've got your slides, and then I'll hand over the clicker. Jeroen, you will be, I think, following right after. Yeah. Okay. Okay. May I invite you guys back to your seats? Thank you. Cool, we're doing great. Hugo, are you feeling confident? This is your big moment to shine. I know you've been practicing in the mirror for the last 2 weeks. And so this is where the magic happens. Stella's already staring at you. It's going to be a good one. Testing, testing, testing. So there's a magic distance from here between the crackle and a smooth voice. Can you increase more volume and then we stay further away from the microphone? Max power? Max power, max power. Yeah.
Is this okay? Can everybody hear me? Kyle, can you hear me? No. Speaking. Okay.
Can we turn all the microphones on again,
gentlemen? Yeah, there we go. Thank you very much. Can we have the microphones for the panelists also on? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Hugo, the floor is yours. Everybody is, I think, ready to pay attention to you.
Can I start? Okay. So I'm Hugo. I'm one of the partners in Bali Investment Club, and Tom asked me to do a presentation, which I normally don't do, actually, so I'm quite happy to be presenting. And he asked me to do a bit of an inspirational talk, so I was thinking about using this question to inspire you guys. Does the world really need this? I'll explain why I come up with that question. He, by the way, also asked me to shorten it to 5 minutes, and then he gave me 10. So I hope I will stay within the 10 minutes, and otherwise you'll cut me off if you miss the message. Short background, it's a bit small here. Actually, it's not there. No, it's not. Okay. Here. Yeah. So I started my first company called Bridge Global like 20 years ago, 17 years. It's a software development company, like SmartMates, but then with a team in India. It's got about 100 people right now. Very good management team running the company. So 6 years ago, I moved to Bali and I started a new company called Equipa. And Equipa helps big, fat dinosaurs, corporates in Jakarta to become more like startups. So we help them with adopting the agile way of working, changing the structures, changing the way they think about work. And I felt that this is not yet enough to help change the world, because corporates are part of the problem that we're trying to face with impact startups and with impact investing, I think. My personal opinion. They might think otherwise. So I joined Bali Investment Club about a year ago, and at the same time, end of last year, I started a company called Superchargers together with Faye here, who is busy on her phone. Faye is running KUMPUL. So she's got a big network with startups. And together we started Superchargers as a venture builder to help startups scale up by infusing our time as entrepreneurs, as experienced entrepreneurs, to help them avoid the pitfalls and mistakes we made. So it's not only money, it can be a financial investment, but it's mostly time that we're investing. So the past year I've thought a lot about what is impact investing. And when I was younger, I was thinking the best way to help the world is to do like Bill Gates does. So I start a company, I sell it, I get very rich, and then I start a charity and you start helping people. This is what most people used to do in the past few decades. But I think right now, impact investing can change the way we try to help society, people, and the planet. So impact investing is basically combining profit with purpose. Right? So it's about, we invest money, we can still make ROI and earn more money, because that's what many people want. At the same time, we're helping companies that do good. So they have a purpose, they have a heart, and they try to solve the important issues that we have today. Now, when I think about this question, does the world really need this? I think this is a very useful compass. I'm assuming, like, who has not seen this before, the 17 SDGs? Anybody who doesn't know it? Okay. Oh, Martin, you work in Shell and you don't know them. So, by the way, I'm also thinking next time we should have no plastic bottles, right? So we have this, I don't know who made this, but I think this is great, helps. We need a dispenser instead of water, plastic, aqua. So the 17 SDGs were created by the United Nations. And I think some very smart people thought about what does our society, what does the world, what does the planet need? So they framed that into 17 goals that express what do we need to do as humanity to make life on the planet better. So when you think about the question, does the world really need this? I think these 17 goals can be your guidance. You can think about, does the company that I support or that I invest in or that I run support these goals? And if they do, they don't necessarily do good, but it's more likely. So when I look at startups that I invest in, I always try to look at how many of these goals are they supporting and in what way are they doing that. I wanted to share two more things that inspired me. That's interesting, still working. So actually, the guy who works at Shell that I just mentioned, him, Matthias here, is my friend. He gave me this documentary of David Attenborough. Has anybody seen this, Life on Our Planet? Okay, not okay, a few. I recommend watching this if you're in this room. This guy, David Attenborough, is, I think, 95 years old, and he traveled the planet to look at, you know, jungle, monkeys, nature, and he did that, like, for 70 years. So in the documentary, he's showing what happened between when he grew up, when he was young, and today. So he shows certain changes on the planet, mostly around climate change, and he uses the Chernobyl disaster, as a case in the beginning and in the end of the story. So in the beginning, he shows that, you know, there was a big problem and everything exploded, people don't live there anymore. And he also showed that in the end, actually nature takes back the buildings that were abandoned. So Earth has a way to restore the things that we as human beings have, let's say, screwed up. Yeah? So for me, this was an eye-opening documentary. After watching it, I started thinking, you know, do I want to contribute to the solution to the problems that he describes? Or do I want to help destroy the planet and make it worse, right? Do I want to go into an airplane and put more CO2 into the atmosphere? Do I want to use a bottle like this, or do I use plastic? Everything we do has a trade-off, and it has an impact. I've got three kids, so I've been thinking it's better to take my chances and try to do the first one that I described. So to try and help restore the balance, to make sure that my kids have a good place to live into the future. I think that people can also see nowadays, in Europe this year, temperatures go up to 40 degrees. I'm Dutch. In Holland, when I grew up, when it was 32 degrees, people were complain. They always complain. But they complained about the temperature. We thought it was very hot. But this year, it reached 38 degrees when I left Amsterdam, which is quite substantial. And we might think, oh, coincidence. But I think it's serious. We're all contributing to this. And I think we have to do something about it. The second thing that I wanted to give is this book, The Donut Economics. Anybody read it? Oh, that's great. Nobody. Okay. That's good. I brought something new. So what she describes in her book is the donut. I'm not sure it's visible. It's a bit strange. But basically, this is the donut, right? So we get a donut here. And this helps to answer again the question, does the world really need it? Now, what happens here in the middle, we've got the social foundation. So inside this means people can have a good place to live, they have access to healthcare, to education, they have food, water, etc. Now, problems that need to be solved are shortfalls in this. So poverty, people that are hungry, we want to help restore that balance and bring them to the outer circle. This one is the ecological ceiling, which is basically the limit of what our planet can sustain for our economic activities. So once we get outside those boundaries, we get climate change, we get acidification of the ocean, and using this again as a compass, we can think about when I invest in a company or when I help a company or start a company, to what extent does it help solve this, the problems inside the inner circle, and to what extent does it help to not go beyond the ecological ceiling? So again, it's one of the ways to think about how can I have impact and stay within the balance. So my message is the world needs more investors who think about making money, which is not a bad thing in itself, and at the same time think about how can I put that money into companies that have an impact. Because it's not the either-or decision. We can invest money in companies that do good, at the same time have big ROI, because I also think it's big business. It's going to grow in the next few decades. All the problems that we know of have to be solved. So it's a big business that we can go into. And we need more investors who contribute to this. I also think we need more entrepreneurs who, more entrepreneurs who ask themselves, how can I contribute and use my drive, my entrepreneurial energy, to have a purpose and impact, to do stuff that helps to balance the planet and stay within that donor that I've just shown. Now, what can you do? So if I triggered anything, you're an investor, I hope that you, if you have money to invest, you join our Bali Investment Club to invest in the founders and the startups that you've seen today, some of them, not all of them are a Bali Investment Club, by the way, because you can put money through us. We screen everything, we have a pipeline, we do the due diligence, so that as an investor, it's more comfortable and easy to make decisions what to invest in. You can also ping me for superchargers. So if you have a startup or you want to start a startup, or you're an experienced entrepreneur who wants to mentor people, ping me for this and you can help to, we can help you supercharge, or as a mentor, you can help some of our startups. I don't know if this works, but this is my WhatsApp. So in case somebody wants to ping me, scan this. Thanks. I think I don't get questions, right?
Yeah, that was awesome. I can't believe you didn't want to speak today. The crowd would have really missed out. So another round of applause for Hugo. Hugo, here, come back here. Very inspirational character. Hugo is probably one of the nicest individuals that you will be able to work with. He's an agile coach. He's been agile coaching the big team, every single startup that we have. And I feel that we wouldn't be where we are today if you weren't part of the team. So please, thank you very much for being with us and for sharing this awesome story. Hugo knows what's going on, even though he's very humble about it. He knows exactly what's going on. So thank you. Okay. So now we are on to the final leg of our event. We have four more startups that are going to present with us today. I would like to invite another Hugo to come and tell us the story of Pasar Micro. So just to give you just a little background, Pasar Micro was in the stage of finalizing their fundraise when we spoke to them about attending this event, and they actually closed the fundraising. So this is kind of like a story tell for you in a way. So thank you very much for joining us. Here's your microphone. We will give you 3 minutes to speak and a couple of minutes for the Q&A.
Thanks, Tom. Yeah, I'm from Pasar Micro. My name is also Hugo, also from the Netherlands. And I'm here to tell a bit more about our company. We're the first companies in Indonesia that offers a commodity trade platform for smallholder farmers and their traders. And we are on a mission to upskill them and do this through tech. We are an agri-fintech company. Well, what's the problem we try to solve? Indonesia has a huge agricultural sector, but very fragmented, conventional, cash-based. People have limited access to liquidity, and it is intransparent. So what does Pasar Micro do? We built an Android app, since many farmers have already smartphones, and we focused on a particular pain point. Farmers, when they sell their goods, usually get paid late. So they have to wait for the trader to bring the envelope with cash later on. So what we said, if you come onto our platform, we make sure you get your money straight away when you sell your goods, and we give 3, 7, or 14 days payment terms to their buyers. And these are small traders we're talking about. And by doing this,
Try speak a little bit off the mic. You're going to find the magic spot, and then your voice will be soft.
All right, sorry. Do people hear me still? All right. Great. So what we're doing is getting them on the platform and offering them finance, marketplace, and trading tools. And everything is done cashless, which has never done before, which is an important element to digitize this world. How do we make money? We get a credit margin, the traders pay, we get fees, and we offer soon also a subscription model. And what happened over the past year, we grow
really fast. So we're now at 15 million GMV, actually already over that. We have more than 900 farmers and traders on the platform. And the good thing is people stay with us. So 85% cohorts continue coming back. And we did this always, first a very small team, now it's a bit over than 20 people and very little capital, because every 10 days we can reinvest because the money comes back. Who is in this space? Actually, if you look at the agri space today, most are so-called integrated value chain players. They build their own network, warehouses, etc. We said we build a platform and try to enable those smallholders and traders by offering solutions like finance, a marketplace. And in that sense, especially at the upstream side, all on the other side is e-groceries, we're quite alone. I'm not alone. I built this company with Dean Wong and Edo. Dean is a tech entrepreneur, and Edo helps us building the operations.
Time's up.
And I'm a commodity banker. And I'm actually looking here today at companies who want to join us, helping these micro entrepreneurs. We call them micro heroes, and see how we can work together. Thanks.
All right. Thank you very much, Hugo.
Please, any questions?
For the panel, do you microphone still good?
So I love companies that Aussie farmers needing to be big to survive, so I like it when you support the little guys. So if I'm a little farmer, I get your app. How do I get money on it? Do I transfer from my Mandiri, or what? How does the money come in and out?
So what we noted is actually most of the farmers do have bank accounts, but they are dormant. And yes, everything goes through our app, the trade and also the payment, and it gets into their, well, most of them have BRI, which is the biggest agricultural bank, so it gets into their BRI bank account.
So they would plug their bank account details into your app, they were, and then you would go from your bank A and it would go back into whatever they had.
Yes.
And how are you? So the rural farmers are doing this because you've got someone who goes out and says you want money now instead of money later, and then you're getting a massive uptake?
So, we use the network effect. Traders the agricultural traders, which are aggregators, small guys with a lorry, they have their network already. So we're solving a problem for them because they usually have a limited liquidity. They bring on their entire network of farmers, and those farmers want to be on the platform because they get their payment fast and they know when they get paid, because usually they don't know, maybe next week, a week later. Mm. So that's a trigger for them to get onto the platform.
And you've raised money already?
Yes.
How much?
We raised 1.5.
What valuation?
15 million.
1.5? That's not bad.
Yeah.
That's not bad at all.
Thank you.
Okay, well done. Where do you see the sort of the choke points? Is it, can you just keep on scaling with, you know, in Indonesia as much as you want to? Like, what's stopping you growing faster? Fast growth already?
The challenges we have is, so if there are people here who has a network, we need more people, especially on the tech side and on the product side. And what else is capital, not so much for our growth, but the funding. Limits, but we disperse that cash to our farmers, and the more farmers in our network, the more money we need.
So you get thirsty for
cash? Sorry?
Do you get thirstier for cash the more people sign up?
Well, if that comes overnight, yes. Thanks. Yes.
Yeah, we're running out of time, but please explain what is looking for that you're looking for.
So there are many parties in the agri value chain that actually want to source goods, but they cannot source it from single farmers. So we have a huge network of farmers we can connect them with. But there is also a lot of tech players that also become traders, right? So they are in need of working capital too. So we can give them the liquidity if everyone comes on board onto our platform, because we scale through onboarding key players who bring on their network, but also through partners. So at this point, it is a requirement, and yes, there are rural areas where that is not yet the case. So we're working with a few local banks, BTPNS, which is a big microfinancier, to help them getting a bank account.
Are you guys looking for capital now?
No.
You're not?
Oh, debt, yes.
You're looking for debt?
Yes.
Okay, and what is your what are your annual revenues right now?
So our annualized revenue is 15 million.
Okay.
That's your GMV, right?
GMV, yeah.
What's your revenue?
Yeah, so to explain how it works, we're operating on our trading model. So we buy from the seller and back to back to a trader. So it basically becomes our revenue. Our margins, which was one on the slide, we charge 60 basis points per transaction. So if we have an annualized, that's 28% return on the capital we put in.
Okay.
And currently, our cost of funding is around 10.
All right. We have time for maybe one last question. What I'd like to ask the audience so long is to please fill in the scorecard, because we'll be using to give the Passat Micro team their rating at the end of the session. Do we have any last questions from the panel? Yes, no. I think everybody's good. Hugo, thank you so much for still joining us today and for sharing your story. Right. Up next, I'd like to invite a startup that we've heard about and we've been working with a little bit for the last couple of months. It's actually very similarly, well, it's very connected to Passat Micro, focusing on a different aspect of the agri-tech landscape. I'd like to invite Jeroen from Bali Co-op. Here we go. Hello. Microphone should be good. Hello. Here's your clicker. Hand on the chest. So we identified, thanks to you, Hugo, that the magic spot on the microphone is you can put your hand, you can hold it. I think let's try it this way.
This sounds good, everybody? Oh yeah, this sounds real good.
So you can hold
right.
it.
That's right. That's right.
Alrighty. All right. Are you ready?
Oh my God, it's not.
Well, team, can we please double check?
Great.
We have our, there we go, okay. You have 3 minutes starting now.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jerome, and thank you, team, for having us here today. We are, what is Bali Co-op? We are a blockchain-based fair trade platform for healthy food. So basically, is this not my, I'm sorry, but that's the not the right one, presentation ones. Yeah, it's the old one.
Okay. So I think you're just going to have to wing it. I don't know how this went, but the information's mostly right, guys.
You're going to have to wing it, Jeroen. Just wing it.
Is you?
Yeah. Are you going to give it to them, or are we doing another one?
Yes. Okay. Please give us 1 second to just to fix the presentation glitch.
Old version.
Okay, we'll restart you on the timer, because otherwise you'd have 45 seconds left. Are we
Sorry
good
about
to
that
go?
Guys.
Do you want to click forward just to double check?
Yeah, that's the one.
Okay, perfect.
Cool. Thank you. So the problem facing is that we're saying that in Indonesia there's a
Can
sharp
you make
decline.
It a bit smaller?
All good? Yeah. So there's a sharp decline in number of farmers. Basically, Indonesia lost 5 million farmers between 2003 and 2013. And by this time, there's going to be no farmers in 2063 because there are too many middlemen and they cannot hardly survive and don't have a good price for their products. So on the same time, we have identified that in the hotel, restaurants and business, there is also a lack of high quality products, free plastic-free deliveries and also consistent deliveries. So, yeah. So our value proposition is healthy food affordable for all, meaning that we're going to reduce the number of middlemen, buying directly from farmers to give good food to the people, and especially that the Indonesian people can buy organic food at an affordable price with zero waste. So this is our addressable market. It's huge, but we are just starting now. So our special recipe is that we partner with farmers today. We work with them directly. We educate them on organic farming. In our team, which I'll bring up later, we have also a permaculture specialist, Kadek, and we also contract price with the restaurants so we can get a better deal for them. Tomorrow, we're going to bring technology like blockchain to basically offer transparency and also security on the transactions. Today, we have started a couple of months ago, and what we do is supply the restaurants every morning with vegetables and fruits. The streams, I'm gonna do it here. Hello, hello. Can you hear me? Okay, so we're gonna transform products like vegan milks. We're gonna make vegan milks and other kind of products, and also products for export like rice. So what we have done, we've started, as you see, quite recently in May. And we have already like tripled our turnover in August compared to the month of July. And basically, how we do that, we have done a lot of preparation work. We work with all the restaurants and chefs, and also hotel owners. And we basically went to them and explained our concept. And until now, we have a high retention rate, and we have some good also testimonials here. So this is our transaction. This is for 2022. How do we compare? We're actually kind of unique because we cater a B2B market with organic products. And today there's not many people doing that on the market. And what we also are unique for is that we have Yasanimas Hitam and Kadek, who is in our team, who's basically guaranteeing, he's been working with farmers for already 8 years, that all the products are organic and we work on with permaculture principles. And also we work with Paxel, which is a company like a kind of a Gojek who delivers to the last mile from our depot to the customer. So we lower our carbon footprint. We don't use our own vehicles. So this is my team that I will bring up later. They're here for the Q&A questions. So Rafi is behind the idea. Actually, he's my co-founder. Kadek, that I talked to you about from Yasane Mas Hitam. And also Tom is in our team and helping us for the strategy with VIC. And we have also Putu, who has a fantastic experience in terms of transformed products. So we got for the next phase. And I'm some people know me. I'm also a social entrepreneur for 9 years. In
all right, all right. You need to wrap it up.
Yeah, I'm done. Good. This is the projection for the couple for the next 3 years. So basically, we have quite of a flat burn rate and an increase in transaction and our farmers spent. Is quite, which our impact indicator is also growing fast. So we expect to basically buy for more than $1 million to the farmers in 3 years from now. That is what we're looking for, 350K. This is how it's divided. And our next steps are to consolidate our B2B footprint and also to start product transformation next year and also the export of organic rice. And our goal is to launch nationwide, let's say, at least in Java in 3 years from now with Indocop.
All right. Thank you very much, Arun. So we've lost about 3 minutes on the Q&A, so we're going to have to keep it tight from your side. I'd like to invite the audience to rate the Bali Cup team so long.
Yeah, okay. Can I also ask my team to come?
Please.
For the Q&A. Other questions?
Microphone's on.
Sorry,
Test.
Okay, so today the thing is that we are buying directly from the farmers to bring kind of a new model. We don't buy from middlemen, and also where we are also kind of unique is that there's not really people who are selling organic products directly to hotels and restaurants.
I really love people who chop out middlemen. I think it's fantastic. And I remember speaking to you before and seeing that your numbers, it looks great. Like you're getting revenues. It's fantastic. Is most of your revenue from B2B, right, at the moment?
Yes.
Only B2B?
Yes.
Have you ever thought of just dominating the B2B space? Because I think when I see what you've done, I remember when you first talked to me, I was like, oh, I'm not sure they're going to be able to do it. But you've actually done really well with it. And I like the idea of these businesses buying organic, but when I sort of see about the other stuff, I'm not sure I really like the idea of exporting rice. Seems like a massive headache. I know that B2C is a difficult one because it's sort of houses, which is, you know, it, I think it adds complexity. And my question would be, how much space is there for you to just dominate all of the B2B space in Bali and then beyond? And would you think about just doing that rather than going on to lots of other things?
Okay, and I'm gonna answer this one. So I'm Raphael. I'm also the co-founder of Bali Co-op. So the idea is not when you give a think about a food system analysis, because it is what we're trying to do, is to change the food system. It's not only about business opportunities, and it's also how to do it, how to implement it, and how to identify the right leverages to do it. Export is a good thing. Export. For the moment, we don't sell a lot of rice, organic rice, because it costs a lot. It's more costly to produce organic rice than to buy conventional rice in the market, Mama rice or whatever. So export could be a very good solution, and not so really have the right partners. For our side, we just need to invest on the supply chain, meaning that we are raising capital also to buy the machine, to be allowed basically to buy a few machines to pack, to sort, to clean the rice, and to prepare it for export. And for the export, we do have already some partners interesting to help us to find customers and where we could sell the rice to. But you're perfect. And also for the B2C market, we are launching soon our community supported agriculture. So it means a weekly vegetable basket for the families. So there we are addressing schools market. So school parents, school families, which also present good opportunities, because a lot of business owners, hotels and restaurants, they send their kids to the schools. And then the idea is to provide to the school, to provide to their kids the same food that they could sell to their customers as well.
Mm-hmm. No, I like it. It's all good. If it was me, I would be focusing on one thing, because it sounds, the rice is, exporting is one awesome business.
Yeah.
Be the consumer with the subscription box, another amazing business, and Blair Ripple and those guys have been doing that well for a long time. And then the B2 sort of the farmer to business is another great business. And I suspect it's going to be difficult to do all three, but you'll probably try to anyway. And so good luck. But I think one of them will turn out to be the good margin and the easier one. And what I would say is I would start to then focus and double down on that one,
yep.
Right? Because you might find a headache getting rice out of Indonesia, is my gut feel.
We have time for one last question.
Yeah. I love what you guys are doing, and talk to me as a potential customer after this, B2B. But one question, also along with like Luke's general question on focus, how important is the blockchain component in your business? Can you deliver the value, your mission and purpose of the company without using blockchain? Is it a really vital component, or is it just like extra work and distraction?
So it's also a matter to address the food system. As today, it's easy for B2B markets, restaurants and hotels, to give us their data, to give us their volumes, to give us their prices, because they record everything. If you ask just your neighboring farmer, he doesn't know what he's been producing last month, last year, 10 years ago. He doesn't know. So we need to find a solution as well to record everything that we do and everything that they do. Because as the farmers we are working with, and we are not the only customers. And also it's important for the government to know what they are producing on their own land. It's pretty much a country needs to know what they're producing. So the best way for us to do it and to make it transparent is to collect everything on blockchain. And so, of course, we don't need blockchain to grow potatoes or carrots. We don't need technology, we just need knowledge and wonderful people like Kadek, because they know how to do this perfectly. But the blockchain allows us to bring transparency, to bring trust, and to bring security to the market. And also payment facilities for export or even for restaurants, like Hugo from Passamicro said, we are paying the farmers every day. So we take on us the pain to take the credit that the restaurants and the hotels take on us. Sometimes they pay every 15 days, sometimes they pay every 30 days. So the blockchain and technology will allow us to create a wallet for them, for they can pay in front for their monthly quantities. So it's also a very nice opportunity for us, and it doesn't make a hole in our treasury and in our working capital.
All right. Thank you very much, Rafael Hill, and the rest of the Bali Cup team. Warm round of applause. Thanks, guys. Thank you. I hope you were able to help rate the team using our Angel and Founder scorecard. I'll give you a couple of seconds to finish doing so before we invite our next company, who actually already presented yesterday at T-Hub. We have also one of a future rock star. Well, I don't know if it's a future rock star because you already are a rock star. So please, Salma, would you like to come on stage? And we would like to present to you Tenang. Okay, clicker, microphone. Yeah. Okay, looking great. You have 3 minutes to pitch. Check. And then 7 minutes max for Q&A. And for the mic, try keep it here.
All right.
And then.
Yeah. Good?
Yeah.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm so glad to be here. I'm Salma, a clinical psychologist and currently developing Tenang, which means peaceful or calm, your 24/7 companion for better mental health. We're trying to solve the pain points of mental health in Indonesia and around Southeast Asia. You need to see how bad is it in Indonesia. Well, first, yeah, there's this stigma. Society can judge you like a spirituality or just crazy knowing you're going to psychologist or psychiatrist. And also there's this unavailability of mental health support after working hours. Even our 911 call for mental health doesn't work after 5 p.m. So where do people should get help when they cannot seek anyone at midnight or even at dawn? And also there's this shortage of professional help in Indonesia. Therefore, we developed Tenang, a faster, better, cheaper mental health platform which upholds your privacy, confidentiality, have access for you 24/7, and also use an AI-powered chatbot. And yes, we started in Indonesia. We're targeting millennials and Gen Z, and also aiming to expand to some countries in Southeast Asia, just because we believe that there are similar pain points that needs to be solved in mental health area in Southeast Asia as well. And what is Tenang actually? It is an AI-powered mental health and wellness application to detect, prevent, and level up teenagers and adults with three features that we developed. For example, you're talking to an AI companion saying you're heartbroken and so on and so far, and our AI companion is able to actually give you the right response and give you the right direction in the middle of the night. And yes, we are supporting sustainable goals in numbers of support. And our business model starts with a B2C model with subscription base. We have three plans for now, but we're also aiming to go far to B2B, B2C, and also B2G itself. And our go-to-market plan, we believe that this mental health issues is about humans, so we are working with some communities, organizations to attract customers, also working with some
advertisement, social media, and also government and companies as well. And in this year, we have accomplished graduation from Founder Institute Accelerator, also second winner in Astra startup competition. And also we have gotten some initial traction of 300 paying customers around 200, 300, while developing our mobile application. So it's not launched yet, but we have gotten some initial traction. So we see that it's a good initial step for us. And we do have some competitors around the market. Here is the Southeast Asia market, but we believe that we have more values that we can offer to the customers since we are also the first mental health platform using AI in Indonesia. And as for the team, I know that building this is not easy. That's why we work with some great team across the globe. We have our chief AI in German as well. We have some lean team and also working with some advisor who have advice in similar area. So last but not least, we are looking for 1 million to develop our product more. So thank you.
Could we maybe hold the microphone antenna up? Does that help?
So I have a lot of questions actually. maybe specifically for the technology, right? Mental health and AI. I mean, we can already straightforward see it, like for example, Veronica bought for Telkomsel that, if we have questions around whatever and then they answer, and then at the end, usually customer getting several packages, say, do you wanna buy data or whatever, right? How do you actually use it for mental health, right? And then is it really working? As in, this is like very delicate subject. And then how has you prove it, right? Like in terms of product market fit, the retention, how do you see it? You say 300 paying customers, how's the retention rate?
Okay, thank you for the question. Well, we have similar startup that's already proven in US and India called WISA. So basically our AI base is made from conversational NLP combined with cognitive behavior therapy. So it's actually guided based on the psychologist itself, and we made it transformational so people can rant in the middle of the night. They don't usually pick anything. So it's actually different from the chatbot that actually the customer service use. So we try to make everything more dynamic, more flexible for people so they can actually rant and get help. That's why we try to make more advanced AI than that. And for the initial traction, we have got 300 paying customers. They are actually having one-on-one counseling session with the psychologist itself. And 80%, almost 90% of them actually have sessioned after working hours. And most of them actually have sessioned around 8 up to 11 p.m. in the middle of the night. And also 90% of the people that actually fill out the form actually fill them out around midnight and even at dawn. So it seems that people actually need help at around that time.
Maybe it's different for you. I mean, like when I asked you about retention, what's success for you? Is it people using you more or less?
Okay. It's more people actually coming back to use us again. So the retention rate for the initial customers are 80%. And for this app itself, we are aiming to have some self-help activities digitalized that people can use to actually level up themselves. So this kind of mobile application doesn't only work for people to actually cure the mental health issues, but also to level up themselves to become a better self.
Hi. Thank you for the presentations. I like the presentations. I have a question about the mental health issues. Usually, it's very specific and very personal. How do you have? is your AI is just a preliminary question, then it brings you to a one-on-one. What's the model then?
Okay, for the model, the AI would be free, so people can just chat into the AI. But for the subscription base, we are going to put that to the consultation and also the self-help activities. And for the AI itself, that's a bit technical stuff, but the simple way to put it that way is this AI will give the psychological first aid that people can use to guide them through some mental breakdown when they experience it in the middle of the night. And this AI, yeah, like I said before, it's made based on the digitalized CBT and also NLP, that's more advanced AI. So yeah, if you want, I can show you the AI itself, how it works. Thank you.
All right, Salma, thank you so much for your time. We need to move on to the last participant of the day. One last round of applause. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay. Bintang Kinchil team, you are 1 minute away. So thank you for joining us. Here's the microphone. Here is your clicker, and your slides are already ready. You can just click down. We're going to hard cut you at 3 minutes of pitching, and then we can only do 5 minutes in Q&A now. All right. All the best.
Hi, everybody. I'm Melia from Bintang Kecil. How to click it? Okay. So 3 years ago, President Jokowi expressed his concern to us about the scarcity of Indonesian children's songs and how Indonesian children doesn't know and love their art and culture anymore. And that's become the problem because the golden age of children until 8 years old, they really need positive inputs every day to build the good characters for their future later on. Nowadays, those children get negative inputs from social media mostly, according to data from YouTube. And that's because also 92% of parents, they cannot control the usage of their children gadgets. And 80% cannot afford the non-academic school educations that needed to build the characters. So we help Indonesian children, 89 million Indonesian children, so they can explore their maximum potential with our obtainable user of 100,000 children for using Bintang Kecil. There we can get the valuation of $39 million in 3 years. And we consistent by giving the children positive inputs and activities every day by providing Bintang Kecil TV channels that contains 8 hours of educational fun and Indonesian children music for Indonesian children anywhere in the without regardless their class or their income, parents' incomes. And we for the children also they can join the interactive the classes via Zoom, teach by the teacher from leading schools, and they also can get application of Bintang Kecil. Contains 800 recorded non-academic class, 700 Indonesian children songs and the karaoke. They can only pay for 100,000 rupiah for that 60 classes per month. And our business model, 60% by subscription plan and the 40% by the B2B collaboration with companies and also promotional. Next, please. And we penetrate the market by collaborating with many parties like artists, influencers, by making events, competition, and other programs. And we have the competitors that have differentiation, and also we make collaboration with them.
Please wrap it up.
Okay. And this is our team, and we believe that we can reach the target in 3 years and break the get the break-even points in 18 months. And we need the funding for $400,000 to reach to reach 30 million revenue in 18 months. Thank you. I believe that together we can make the better future for Indonesia. Yes, we already launched on 30th January last year. We have 6,000 downloaders, 300 students, and we also have 2,000 subscribers. Yes, we collaborate with schools, art courses, artists, influencers, and public figures too. Yes. Right now we have daily users, 600 daily users. 600. Yes. And we make already make projection for 5 years, mm-hmm. and that $400,000 we will use to build the team and to make the best version of Bintang Kecil.
Yeah, okay, maybe I'll just, okay, who's your power users and what's their characteristic right now?
Now we're having users from all around Indonesia. They are children aged 4 until 12 years old, because nowadays they are lack with the inputs, Indonesian inputs. So when they were there, they join the Bintang Kecil, and their parents and the children are so happy, and the parents also gave testimony that the children's characters is becoming, is changing, becoming better, becoming more loving and care to others.
Yeah, maybe just my final question would be the breakdown of your target, right, of the 10 million, and then where is the base? Are you already have your data, and then you can scale it from there? Can you explain it to me?
Oh yeah, we will use that 400,000, 40% for marketing, and 25% for team building, and the rest we will use for operational and the development. Only 100,000 is $10.
That's your acquisition cost.
Yes. Oh, you mean CAC?
Yeah,
like
the cost to acquire one.
Yeah. Our CAC actually now becoming only 20,000.
Do you do you make content? Are you you're making the shows?
Yes, every day we make classes. So we make non-academic classes like drawing, singing, and we have language, also foreign language, coding, content creating. So right now we are the cheapest, and we are also the most complete platform in Indonesia for non-academic.
And your content that you produce, is it branded? Like, are there characters that they like the Wiggles? You know, like sort of, you know, what are they called? Teletubbies? Is it like that, but for Indonesia?
Yes. Right now we're having producing. It's called Mimi Peri. Mimi Peri is means angel. Mimi angels and three children like Barney, but it's for bigger children, and they teach about the beauty of Indonesia, how many language in Indonesia, and that the aim is to make the Indonesian children to know, to love, and to be proud of their own culture. And also we make classes every day, two classes until three classes every day, not academic, teach by the teachers from leading schools like Kaseto Homeschooling, Swan Ballet, Sarang Cerita, and many more.
All right, Melia, thank you so much for being able to join us. I know it was almost didn't happen, so I'm glad you could make it. Thank you to all of you for sticking with us and riding the heat of the day with us. One round of applause for the Bintang Kecil team. All right. So we're nearing the end of the session upstage. Just to put you in the loop, we actually have a yoga session happening here in a couple of minutes. As you can see, we are in a yoga shala. And so what I would like to do is I would like to give you finally a real microphone to work from. And if you wouldn't mind, maybe starting with you, Lavinia, sharing your impressions of the pitches that you saw today, what you liked, what you think can be improved on with regards to the flow of the event also. This is your time to share your impressions with us. Once we've gone through the panelists, Gil will pick up for the rest of the sessions, which we'll be hosting in the cafe downstairs for the deep networking final. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I thought we had a really, really good mix today of different industries, a little bit different stages, right? But all of them with quite interesting traction and many of them revenue already, quite proven MVPs already. One thing that that I really liked is the connection between the passion and the background and the purpose that the founders believe in. I think that's always really important. And obviously for an event by BIC, that's key, right? To have people who do something they're passionate about and also serves a purpose and a good social impact. So I was really impressed with many of the pitches, and I really look forward to following their journey.
All right, thank you so much. Just one last quick question for you. If you have a message to potential angel investors, that attended the session today or that are actually watching us online, we have been live streaming this event. What would be a first step for somebody to want to get involved with startups? What's the important thing to remember as an aspiring angel investor?
Right, so people who haven't invested yet at all.
Exactly.
Right? I think obviously just going back to what Hugo was talking about, we always talk about how the world can be changed by a small group of people that believe that change is possible. And I think people like the ones we've seen today and the ones that BIC is funding generally are amongst those. If you can combine potentially, making good returns on something as well as contributing to something that develops social impact and serves society in a positive way, it's a no-brainer. Right? Why not? It's a typical win-win situation. So I'd say, back in the day, investment tickets used to be quite high. It was high entry. It was something accessible just for an elite. Right now, things are different. So why not give it a try?
All right, fantastic. Thank you so much, Lavinia. Team, we also got goodie bags. I hope you're ready with them. Thank you. Alex.
It was really, really heartwarming to see so many smart people that are devoted to making an impact. It's my favorite kind of an investment where you can make money by helping the world, by truly riding the rails of capitalism and making that economic machine do social good. It's truly inspiring. So look, it's not easy standing up in front of a large group of people and putting your heart and soul and life's work in front of everybody. So I think all of the entrepreneurs deserve a massive round of applause again, because that was definitely hard. So truly, truly inspiring work. Great job, entrepreneurs. Just on the topic of words of advice, definitely know your numbers, right? The investor is going to want to know returns, is going to want to know your acquisition costs. They're going to look at your deck, and if you're missing Q4 in your deck, they're going to notice. There's, I'm going to use it as an Easter egg hunt. One of the projects had made that typo, and just be extra sure that you proofread the deck before you come up in front of a large group of people. But other than that, you know your numbers, know your business, and tune your message to your audience. There's going to be different types of people that you're going to be talking to in your ecosystem. And with the pitch competition, you're definitely talking to investors. So tune that message. Make it as easy and as simple as possible for your community, for your investors to understand. My litmus test, and maybe that's a sign that I'm talking too much, but my litmus test is try and explain it to your mom or your dad. And if it's that easy to understand or explain, then that passes the test.
Thanks, Alex.
Thank you, Alex.
Should I continue?
please.
Congratulations again for all the participants. Great job, very inspiring and exciting at the same time. For my take for the presentation, I think that I would want to see, as an investor, I would like to, and also a long-time founders myself, I would like to see very clear products that you're working on, especially because I'm in tech, so I really want to know what you're working on, the features, and then the second is to be really know for sure product market fit, right? And then what makes your product stick? That means knowing your all the numbers that you said, all the data, and understand that. Maybe we can talk after this about what's product market fit means for startups. And also what's also important for me is founder market fit. So if you think that you are a founder that is really the right one for your startup, really showcase that as well. Make time to explain your experience and who you are. Thank you and good luck for you all.
Hello. I'm Luke. I grew a company and then sold it, and I now have a little venture studio which creates new companies here in Bali. So I see a lot of guys. And I do some early stage investing as well. I would sort of echo some of those points. I think a lot of the time I see people who try to raise money a little bit too early, or they try and say they want, you know, $1 million before they've really got sort of nice traction. If, you know, when I'm an investor, when I look at a company like Book.io, and you just look at that graph and you can hear the stories about that, I want to get into that company, right? You see that and you want a part of that journey. And so I think what I like to do is raise as little as possible and then hit a few milestones and make them look good. Then go and race again and hit some more milestones after that, right? And make things super simple if you can. I would say if you're an angel investor, I've had a lot of things I've invested in blow up, and then I've had some other guys invest alongside me in those things, and then I've had some other things that have done amazingly that are sort of 100 plus X. And my friends who are in one of them that blew up feels really shit, and the ones who's with me in the 100X feels really amazing. So I would try and find some sort of a fund that can invest in a lot of things. I mean, BIT is a great example, right? You can invest your money across lots of startups, and half those startups are probably going to blow up. But you don't care because you've got the other halves. It could be that Book.io is such an amazing exit. Maybe that's their Uber, and then it doesn't matter what any of the other ones do. But if you try and pick company by company and you're new and you have some money and try and do that, you'll probably blow it up. You'll lose the money. I remember when I first sold my company and I talked to my financial guy and I said, how do I lose this money I've just got? He said, one of the ways to do it is get into angel investing and invest into these companies and they blow up. Because when you invest in angel companies, if they go wrong, your money's gone. It's zero. It's not like the markets where it goes up and down. It goes either really well or zero. So I would say go to a nice fund across everything. I really like the company as I saw today. There's a few that I would, think about investing in. But again, I would like to see real traction, revenue. I want to see people buying the product. Are there thousands of people buying it, or do I have to buy those people? If it's all happening really well, then it's a wonderful thing. It's tricky because sometimes you're not the darling at the ball, right? Sometimes you're not the best, you're not the best company. You're just sort of plodding along. If you're plodding along, try and find some good angels who can help you, and then try and get to the stage where everyone's, clambering to get a piece of you, because it's difficult out there. And I, thank you for doing that. If you're an entrepreneur, do more of those things. Do way more, a lot, while running your business. But no, I was impressed today. So it was great. Thanks. Thanks, BIC guys.
Thank you so much, Luke.
I've
think pretty much everything that needs to be said has already been said, so I'm not going to add too much. So, but basically, more of a personal story. I really, literally didn't get a chance to sleep at all. Like, I slept at 5:30 a.m. this morning. I was like struggling. Am I going to fall asleep listening to all the speeches? And apparently, you guys managed to keep me awake. So that's a good sign. Yeah. So yeah, I'm not going to preach too much or like not preach, but just like pretty much all the good tips are taken. I really don't need to add any much anymore. Keep your story interesting. Make your pitch understandable. Well, you guys mostly did, which is a good thing. Yeah, and I think Gil mentioned 95% of the people you meet are not going to give you money. Build that stamina. Get ready to say to a lot of no's. That's also one thing that I have to say, because I'm also actually like nurturing a lot of ventures, and I'm personally also experiencing a lot of that. So yeah, we're all in this together.
Stella.
Hi, thank you guys. Thank you BIC for organizing this. This is my second BIC event, and I see how you guys grown from your first event in Ubud. There are many, many companies. There's a lot of like interesting startups now, more local startups, I think. I'm always interested to see Bali startups ecosystem, not just Bali, maybe outside Bali as well. But I'm one of the early backers for Bukapeo, and I'm very, very happy to see that this thing that looks like a dream a year ago, I think at the end of this year we might able to have a partial exit. So this, I think, it's a big win for a small startup from Bali to go against the big Jakarta startups from a small island. So I'm happy to be a part of it, and thank you BIC for making that happen. So yeah, keep inviting more local entrepreneurs, local startup. There's a lot of good ideas here. I think we just need a space to have that, and you guys have, you guys provide this space, and when you provide that, I think people will come and get together and present or network and have community, I guess. So, and for the founders, entrepreneurs, you guys done a great job. It's always hard to go pitch. You're not comfortable with the language. It's always nervous, nerve-wracking. But it's a good exercise. And yeah, good job, guys.
All right. Thank you so much for being on this journey with us, Stella. Thank you to the rest of the panel for joining us today. We do have a small gift that Stephanie will be presenting to you now. I would like, I'm going to hand this microphone over to Mr. Gill, as he'll be needing it in a couple of seconds. I just received the results for today's top three startups. So thanks to your help, we were actually able to calculate who you thought were the best presenters of the day. So I would like to invite Pasar Mikro, Magalava, and Bubme on the stage. You are the top three rated startups of the day. Let's get a photo. We'll put Rice in the middle. Okay. Ladies get the front stage. And then big round of applause. Thank you. All right. So I've just received a message that the yogis in this place really, really want their shala back. And so something you learn when you come to Bali is don't mess with Ubudians, don't mess with the yogis. So we will be very polite and give them the space back. I'd like to invite Gil, because what's happening now is that we need to all wake up a little bit. We've been sitting here for a while. The heat has really gotten to our heads. And I must thank you once again to all of you that actually have stuck around for the whole session. I know what it's like to be here for a couple of hours, to our panel, for being so well behaved, because obviously everyone's looking at you the whole time. You can't just run away. And so now, Gil, has been joining us for the last while, and he has some absolute magic on what comes next.
So guys, what I'm going to suggest is initially we're going to keep everyone in here, but apparently the yogis want to do their yoga. I'm curious to see how big of a class this is. Bet you it's like two people that show up and want to do some yoga, but it's okay. So what I'm going to suggest is as we move downstairs to the space that where the cafe is, behind the cafe, there is a setup where some of these companies are presented today, if not all of them,
that's right,
have a little booth where they want to talk to you. What I'm going to suggest, I hope they have a microphone working downstairs, is at one stage when we go downstairs, hopefully don't rush home right away. I'll grab your attention. Yeah, I'll be okay with that. If you do hear me trying to grab your attention, give me a moment of your attention. What I want to try to do with you downstairs is play a few exercises to see how well we can get to know each other, how quickly we can expedite how people tend to network, and how you could choose to network, how you could ask for a solution that might not be around today, or how you can ask for advice and potentially attract a strategic partnership or a mentor from someone around you today. So what I'm going to suggest is as you walk downstairs, maybe consider, you know, what do you really need, and consider who you're walking downstairs with. Some of you are still sitting next to you. Who's still sitting next to their partner or best friend? Be honest. Yeah, you guys are sitting next to your partners, and you guys are sitting next to your partners, and people are like, no, no, no. So the idea of to see how we can play around a little bit, and maybe you'll leave today knowing 5, maybe 6 new people. You know, maybe for some of the introverts in the room, you don't want to meet too many people. That's okay if you just meet a couple of people. But again, the result would be that you're not going home not knowing anyone new. I'm a believer that in my life, every single thing that I've ever achieved has been because I've met people along the way. And I believe that every single thing I will always want to achieve in my life, or any dream I have, I will need to meet people along the way. And I believe it works for everyone else in this room. So there is magic of Bali. How many of you believe in magic of Bali? Come on, a little bit of noise for Bali. Yeah, ooh, they're hot, man. They're just hot. They want some water. So as you guys go downstairs, I believe in the magic of Bali. I believe in network manifestation magic. So I beg of you not to go downstairs and rush home, not to go downstairs and grab your phone and sit on the corner and look at everybody like, please, someone come and talk to me. Please, someone come and talk to me. I'll help facilitate that. So as we go downstairs in about 5 or 10 minutes, I'll grab your attention. We'll have some fun. Yeah, thank you guys, and congratulations again to everyone today.
Thank you, Gil. Thank you, Gil. Thank you, Gil. Once again, thank you to all of you for joining us in Angels and Founders 1-3. This event is not possible without your attendance and your support. I'd like to thank the KUMPUL team also and the BWork team for helping us host this event today. And now you're free to rise, stretch your legs, and have Master Gil just take care of the rest. Go downstairs and get something fresh. And once again, thank you so much for joining us. Huge thanks to the big team also for helping us organize. One last round of applause. Thank you. Do we have some cool music to get everybody moving?